and we're looking at rodeo. We do offer private testing during the week from the hours of 9 to 5. We don't fire engines before 9. We don't run them after 5. We have weekly testing on Thursdays that's open to our regular racers, and that is from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock. So we do not burn lights any time other than on race day. These private tests are more frequent around our bigger events, and on regular events we very seldom use the track during the week, so it's a pretty quiet place. Mr. Rick Bowman, probably everybody here knows Mr. Bowman well. He used to be a regular down here. I've never been here, but we've only had the track for 2 years. I don't think you've seen Mr. Bowman in 2 years. We meet with Mr. Bowman and Phil Green. They're the neighborhood representatives for the local neighborhood. We meet with them every year, and we talk about our schedule of past, what they liked, disliked, and we talk about our schedule in the future and see what they like or dislike. And we do try to come to some common grounds. Those common grounds have been in the past, if we do not race on a Friday night, then we don't allow testing on that Saturday. That way they have a quiet weekend, and then we have a busy weekend. But we are willing to talk to our neighbors, but we have to hear from them to do it. You know, if they come here, instead of to Phil or Rick or to myself, we don't know what those issues are. So we are open to the public or our neighborhood to try to be conscious and available to them at any time. A Speedway used to be a weekly racing series. Now we are bi-weekly, so our schedule is much shorter. And in these pictures, which I'm going to run out of time, I'm not going to get in near what I need to. In these pictures, you'll see a lot of race fans, you see a lot of equipment, you see a lot of trucks, and you see cars in the parking lot. You know, what we see is racing and entertainment and excitement. That sound is what comes with it. But what you also see is a lot of taxpayers. They buy fuel, they buy food, they buy ice, they buy beverages. They go to the restaurant and eat early, they eat restaurant late. We have an economic impact on this county that I don't think is justified or noticed. And these pictures show it strongly. And I'll leave it at that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Turner. Thank you for coming out.
Want your picture back?
Yes, please.
All right, next is Bill Hussey.
Good job.
Thank you.
Good morning. This is the petition and the ordinances I'll be referring to today.
And I'll apologize before we get started. I got a cough here. Good morning. My name is Bill Hussey, and I own 11 acres on Soapstone Trail in Snow Camp. I'm here to speak about procedures that are being followed in the revision of the noise ordinance and express. And I want to express concerns on how that might impact the revised HIDO. Recently, the commissioners reviewed the Alamance noise ordinance, and many citizens of the county were concerned that the current ordinance contains an exemption for industry. I am very concerned that an industry such as a crushed stone quarry, which is what we're talking about, which has blasting, stone crushers, heavy equipment, constant heavy truck traffic, can, under the current ordinance, operate 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, with no limits on noxious noise. We were encouraged that the commissioners appeared to see our point at the April 15th meeting. However, after remarks made by the county attorney, you voted unanimously to leave the exemption in, essentially ignoring the voices of many citizens who came to express their concerns and over 300 citizens who signed a petition to support the removal of the industry exemption, and that number is now up over 320. None of the surrounding counties of Orange, Chatham, Randolph, or Guilford, or Forsyth have exemptions for industry in their noise ordinance. Guilford goes so far as to include businesses in their description of sources for unlawful production of disturbing noise. Caswell is the only county that has a business exemption, providing reasonable measures be taken not to disturb the comfort and repose of persons in the immediate vicinity. This could include normal and customary operating hours. So instead, The adopted policy dismisses the expressed concerns of us, our citizens, and totally fails to protect Alamance County citizens under the noise ordinance if we move forward the way we are right now. In reviewing the role of the county attorney, it is generally accepted that his role is to advise the board, the county manager, and the department heads on all legal matters related to the operation of county government and seeing that affairs and actions of the county are conducted in accordance with federal, state, and local laws. There's a precedence here already in the ordinance regarding the HIDO. Alamance County has already determined that working hours for construction noise in the current noise ordinance. So there's already a limitation on what can be done relative to construction. Having one business limited by the noise ordinance demonstrates very specifically that it can be legally done. This is where we really feel we need to be looking at what can happen for the with the county attorney's role in operating with this. And we ask, because we truly believe you guys elected as representatives of the citizenry here of Alamance County, have an obligation to make sure that the noise ordinance and the forthcoming HIDO revisions basically come up with common sense, reasonable approaches to how we can adjust.
Mr. Hussey, it's been 30 seconds.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Allison Ortman.
Good morning.
My name is Allison Ortman, and at the April 15th Commissioners meeting, you elected to strike all of the revisions to the noise ordinance that were presented to you by many of our citizens at a public hearing and follow the policy recommendation of the county attorney to exempt industry instead. Currently, there is no protection for the citizens of Alamance County from unwanted, disturbing, or noxious noises, which degrade our quality of life and deprive us of our ability to peacefully enjoy our community and our property. These words were taken directly from the noise ordinance describing the purpose of the ordinance. I cannot imagine that you consider it is okay for any source of noise, industry, or otherwise to degrade our quality of life and deprive us of the ability to peacefully enjoy our community and property. I ask you, if your house was 1,000 feet from the blasting area of a mine and you had small children, would you want the company to be blasting and crushing stone and hauling gravel at all hours of the night? I do not. And I do not understand how you can limit one noise producing business and not others. There has to be common sense method, whether it's decibel levels, reviews of existing studies, or other, to set reasonable hours of operation for high noise producing industries. You have an opportunity once again this morning to correct this oversight by removing the exemption number 14 from section 7 within the current noise ordinance, and also to address normal hours in the forthcoming HIDO revision. And the only question that the county attorney should be asking, that you should be asking of the county attorney, is it legal to do so? One would believe that the answer is yes, as there is already a precedent setting hours of construction noise in the current noise ordinance, as well as those of other counties. There is also a precedent for limiting the hours of mining operations, which for Martin Marietta are 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. I urge the commissioners to ensure that there are reasonable noise reduction regulations and hours of operations to be included in this noise ordinance and the forthcoming HIDO revision. Let's do this thing right and put in place reasonable hours, 7 a.m. to 5 p.m., that are consistent with both of the existing mines in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you.
Donna Poe.
I don't know how my presence can top that cutie. She's so cute. All right, good morning. I am Donna Poe, and I live in Snow Camp. My request is simple today. to approve agenda item number 10 for a public hearing request and amend the time period requested for a moratorium extension to 60-plus days versus only 59. The present moratorium, originally approved for 120 days, expires on June 4th. A 59-day extension would create a new expiration date of August 2nd, less than 3 months from today. It would appear that this extension period would provide the adequate time needed to complete the revision process for the HIDO. However, we also assumed that the initial 120 days would be more than sufficient, in which it was obviously not. As mentioned previously by the other speakers, based on previous meetings, we are very concerned about how this process has been conducted and will continue to be. The current HIDO revision draft is not even close to what the citizens had requested for consideration, to include your suggestions as well. At the April Planning Board meeting, the draft was to be discussed, though a quorum was not present. Citizens were permitted to offer public comment, who in turn revealed new facts and conditions in the current ordinance not previously understood or realized by the Planning Board members. A brief discussion ensued, with the Planning Board Chair reiterating how seriously flawed this ordinance is and how we need to not be copy and pasting, but coming up with our own words for this new ordinance. The meeting was recessed for the following week, which never happened. As you are well aware, this is a serious situation that has happened in Snow Camp, with a quarry dropped on us like an unsuspecting bomb. And we do not want to gamble and have any more HIDO applications slip in under the current inadequate ordinance, and want to get it right and not rush in the revision process. As discussed in the past, a public hearing is required for both options, the 59 days and the 60 plus, with a 3-day difference in public notification between the two term lengths, according to legislation statutes 153A-340 and 323. Because there is more than sufficient time for public notification before the June 3rd meeting, I strongly urge the 60-plus days period be approved with a 10-day notification. The exact duration of the moratorium extension can then be discussed at the public hearing based on the Planning Board's recommendation and your further consideration. I'm just looking for that proper 10-day notification period so we have options. Thank you always for your time and care for the citizens of Alamance County.
Thank you.
All right, that concludes our public comments today. Do we have any commissioner responses?
I'd like to say to you, I get your name confused with the Tuckers. You remember the Tuckers over in Greensboro? Yeah, my cousin used to build a car, and he'd win every Saturday night at Madison's 311 Speedway. I'm proud of him. They could build an engine. You might not like them. Other people might not like them. Let me tell you a quick story. Right? I was in the pits at a race. It was an ace. But I was in the, went to the restroom. And a guy walked in beside me, and he had the name of my cousin on his back of his shirt. I'm not going to mention her name. I didn't want to call him anyway. I looked at him, and I said, did they build your engine? Y'all's engine? He said, yeah. I said, we paid those blank, blank, blanks $5,000. And it lasted one lap. And I thought to myself, well, the driver probably blew it up. But I said, oh, that's terrible. I probably wouldn't have got out of the bathroom. But the bottom line is, your track, I go to some of the bigger tracks, but I haven't been to a race in a long time. But, and they're out of it. Because of, but Ace looks as good as Martinsville from those pitchers, looks as good as Bowman Gray. And those are some big-time short tracks.
Yeah, we take pride in our product.
Yeah, it looks awfully nice. It really does. I think I'll go to the race.
Well, you have a schedule. I will say this. June 14th is Flag Day. We have a big event for the veterans of Alamance County. Be a good time to come.
I'm proud of that statue. Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you.
Well, I have had
anybody else?
I have had a comment concerning the construction time from a friend, and setting at 8 o'clock cutoff time for residential construction. And I thought about that. If you're trying to build your own, or trying to do part of the work on your own home, 8 o'clock might be a little early to have to cut off. So I can see an issue there. And I wish I thought there was something we could do about the time on this mine. I think it's going to be a
I've got a question to that.
Maybe we should, maybe we reserve our comments about that particular issue until we get to that item on the agenda, you think? So we can have a thorough discussion at that time. Okay, is there any other response? Okay. Then next would be be asking for a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the consent agenda. If everyone has had the opportunity to review the items on the consent agenda and there are no changes, be seeking a motion to approve it.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no further discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, now we have a few proclamations. First is for Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month. And so I am told to read it. I do what Tori tells me to do, so that's what I'm going to do. So, Alamance County Board of Commissioners Proclamation for Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month for May 2019. Whereas the safety and security of the residents of Alamance County are vitally important, more residents are becoming involved in motorcycling, and with the warmer weather approaching, it is time to remind everyone to be alert and to share the road. And whereas the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Motorcycle Safety have named May as Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month, and May is traditionally the time that the number of motorcycles on roadways increases. And whereas motorcycle riding is not only a popular form of recreation and transportation for thousands of citizens across North Carolina and Alamance County, but an economical means of transportation that reduces fuel consumption, road wear, and helps to alleviate traffic and parking congestion. And whereas North Carolina has over 193,000 registered motorcycles and more than 177,000 licensed drivers who have either a motorcycle endorsement or a motorcycle learner's permit. And whereas in 2016 there were 3,644 motorcycle-related crashes that resulted in 385 motorcyclists seriously injured and 152 fatalities. And whereas it is important that the citizens of North Carolina and Alamance County be aware of motorcycles on our roadways and recognize the importance of motorcycle safety and share the roadways. And whereas the safe operation of a motorcycle is enhanced through a combination of rider training and experience, good judgment, and a knowledge of traffic laws and licensing requirements and the use of highly visible safety gear. And whereas several organizations, such as the Alamance County Concerned Bikers Association, along with the North Carolina Motorcycle Safety Education Program, and other state and local motorcycle clubs and riding/social clubs, are committed to increasing the safe operation of motorcycles by promoting rider safety education programs. And whereas Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month is designed to increase public awareness about motorcycles and safely sharing the road with motorcycles, and to encourage their safe and proper use among motorcycle riders. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim the month of May as, quote, Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month in Alamance County, North Carolina, and urge all citizens to join in this effort to promote awareness, mutual respect, and safety on our roads. Signed this 6th day of May, 2019, by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. And I'm told we do not need a vote on that. So, it's an important issue that we should all be aware of. And to remember also that the grass clippings, you know, we've heard from people before, speakers before, reminding us that when people cut their grass, if you blow the grass out in the road, it can create an unsafe condition for that. Hello.
And these are the concerned bikers.
Good morning.
Good morning. We're here to receive the proclamation.
Awesome. Can you introduce yourselves to the board,
will.
Please?
I will. Gene, Brian, Elizabeth. We are the Concerned Bikers. We have lots of members. We're the receiving committee. We'd just like to remind everybody just what you said about the grass clippings.
Yes.
Telephones, when you're driving, please pull over side of the road or have them attached to something. Don't drive while you're talking on the phone. Lots of accidents happen that way. We have a commissioner that rides. He rides safely. Drive safely so that we don't wind up in a ditch or in the hospital.
Right.
really.
Right.
It's important.
Pay attention.
How many problems do we avoid by being considerate of people around us and paying attention to what's going on?
And you save yourself a lot of trouble in the long run.
Yep.
Save a lot of lives.
That's right.
That's right.
Officer John, Terry Johnson doesn't have to wind up at a scene.
That's right. Save a lot of lives. I'm
going to
come around and hand it to you.
Yeah, I saw a picture. Somebody sent me a picture the other day of a young man who had laid his bike down because he had some grass clippings.
So yeah, that's dangerous stuff right
happens.
There.
Yeah.
It's like ice.
Cars just slide, believe it or not, on grass clippings.
Mm-hmm. Here we go. Thank you for coming out today. We're glad to have you here. Nice to see you.
Thank you.
See you around.
Okay, we have another another proclamation. It's also Emergency Medical Services Week. And do we have, let me ask this before I start reading it. Do we have, I see Ray Vickerman is coming forward. Are you going to be accepting the proclamation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. Alamance County Board of Commissioners proclamation for Emergency Medical Services Week, EMS Strong Beyond the Call. This is going to be May 19th through the 25th, 2019. So whereas emergency medical services is a vital public service, and whereas the members of emergency medical services teams are ready to provide life-saving care to those in need 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and whereas access to quality emergency care dramatically improves the survival and recovery rate of those who experience sudden illness or injury, and whereas emergency medical services has grown to fill a gap by providing important out-of-hospital care, including preventative medicine, follow-up care, and access to telemedicine, and whereas the emergency medical services system consists of first responders, emergency medical technicians, paramedics, emergency medical dispatchers, firefighters, police officers, educators, administrators, pre-hospital nurses, emergency physicians, trained members of the public, and other out-of-hospital medical care providers, and whereas the members of emergency medical services teams, whether career or volunteer, engage in thousands of hours of specialized training and continuing education to enhance their life-saving skills. And whereas it is appropriate to recognize the value and the accomplishments of emergency medical services providers by designating Emergency Medical Services Week, and now therefore we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, in recognition of this event, do hereby proclaim the week of May 19th through the 25th, 2019, as Emergency Medical Services Week. With the theme EMS Strong Beyond the Call, we encourage the community to observe this week with appropriate programs, ceremonies, and activities, adopted the 6th day of May, 2019. So, I will come around to this. Okay, we have another proclamation for Municipal Clerks Week. Tori, will you be accepting this one?
She's the only one else.
That's our clerk. So, Alamance County Board of Commissioners proclamation for the 50th anniversary of Municipal Clerks Week, May 5th through 11th, 2019, so that is this week. Whereas the Office of the Clerk, a time-honored and vital part of local government, exists throughout the world, and whereas the Office of the Clerk is the oldest among public servants, and whereas the Office of the Clerk provides the professional link between the citizens, the local governing bodies, and agencies of government at other levels, and whereas clerks have pledged to be ever mindful of their neutrality and impartiality, rendering equal service to all, whereas the clerk serves as the information center on functions of local government in the community, whereas clerks continually strive to improve the administration of the affairs of the Office of the Clerk through participation in education programs, seminars, workshops, and the annual meetings of their state, provincial, county, and international professional organizations, whereas it is most appropriate that we recognize the accomplishments of the Office of the Municipal Clerk, Now therefore, I, Amy Scott Gailey, Chair of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and on behalf of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do recognize the week of May 5th through 11th, 2019, as Municipal Clerks Week, and further extend appreciation to our county clerk, Tori Frank, and to all the other municipal clerks serving their municipalities in Alamance County for the vital services they perform and their exemplary dedication to the communities they represent, dated the 6th day of May, 2019. So, thank you.
Speech.
Thank you.
There we go. Face the camera.
Better. That's a lot better.
Great.
She puts up with me.
She's a good
one. That's worth that.
That's fine.
Well, you don't have to agree, do you?
Yeah, thank you very much, Tori, for all you do. You work very hard and very dedicated.
Yep.
And appreciate you very much. All right. We've all been waiting for it. The presentation of the manager's recommended budget. So, Mr. Hager.
Thank you, Chair Gailey, and commissioners, I'd like to ask if Susan and Andrea could take a moment, pass out handouts for each one of you and for the press, too.
Andrea has yours. You get a special one, Thomas. It's been redacted.
Oh, boy.
Thank you.
Waiting with bated breath.
All right. Everyone got copies? Great. Well, commissioners, let me say I'm here before you this morning to present my recommended budget for fiscal year 2019-20. It's been a lot of work put into this information that's before you. I'd like to thank Susan and Andrea and Michelle and all of our department heads and our outside agency folks who have helped make this possible. It's a lot of information in your hands this morning, but we have a tremendous amount going on in the 19-20 budget. So just let me go over quickly what you have in your hands. I'm going to go through a PowerPoint, and then you ask any questions, of course, as I go along. But you have a copy in front of you, a hard copy of the PowerPoint that I'm going to go through. So if you miss something on the slide and you want to refer back to it, you have it in front of you. You also have a bound copy of the budget ordinance, and there's also inside this document summaries of every department, individual department information. You also have a bound copy of the proposed capital plan for Alamance County government. This is a three-tiered plan. It's the county, school system, and community college, so it's there for your perusal too. And you also have a copy of a proposed memorandum of understanding between the county and the school system for the use of North Carolina lottery proceeds to pay debt on the proposed bond. So all of this information is for your review. Of course, today we're not approving any. I'm presenting this recommendation to you, and we'll go through a budget public hearing, and then you'll have the opportunity to ask lots of questions, and then at some point the budget will be adopted. But out of this information, the budget, the capital plan, and the MOU all require action from the board, so you can be taking a look at it as I go along. So, and after this meeting, we are going to post all this information online too for the public to be able to see. So, with no further ado, I'm going to go ahead and get started. We continue to hold true to our Vision Alamance, our strategic plan, as we developed about 2 years ago. We've put some meat behind this. Strategic plan plays a role in the developing of the budget. We have our five pillars listed here: preserving agriculture, world-class education, smart growth and development, public health and safety, and government accountability and resource management. We use this to help develop the budget, and primarily through working with departments to create performance management goals for next fiscal year. We do not have those goals for you yet. We will. Once the budget is adopted, we'll be able to present those goals to you. Many of the departments hinge their goals on financial constraints. So just an overview of the recommended budget that I'm bringing to you this morning. The total budget is over $208 million. You can see that the general fund budget is a little over $171 million. It's important to note that in that $171 is funding for the county's capital plan. I'm going to touch on most of, if not all of, these funds that are listed here, but our total budget this fiscal year recommendation is $208,316,311. So, breakdown of the particularly the general fund. Our general fund budget request that I presented to you at the budget retreat, a little over $168 million. Please understand that those requests did not include our capital plan. Those were strictly operating requests. The recommended general fund budget, a little over $171 million. And you can see here how that $171 recommendation falls out. County government for operations, a little over $96 million. The capital plan, a little over $25 million, and that's existing debt service, as well as the PAYGOs, which are our CIP money for the school system, community college, and the county. And then a large transfer to capital reserve. Those are funds that I'm going to talk about in a moment, but it will go toward the implementation of the capital plan, particularly for the proposed bond project. So for education, for operations, the capital piece for education is there under capital plan. Operations for the education groups, that's ACC and ABSS, almost $46 million. And then for outside agencies, I'm recommending the funding level of a little over $3.2 million. You will note on this slide that I'm recommending a property tax rate of 67 cents. That is an 8-cent increase from our current rate of 59 cents.
Now, is that inclusive of bonds, and school bonds?
And indeed.
Everything?
Yes, it is. Cap. And I have a slide here where I'll break down where those funds go. So, revenue sources, we rely heavily on property tax revenue, of course. I'm proposing a 67-cent property tax rate. Our property tax collection rate percentage that we're using is 98.92%. This would equate to a little over $15 million in new property tax revenue. The vast majority of that is being created by the property tax rate increase. Then for sales tax revenue, another one of our major staples, we're projecting 2.4% growth. That's growth over what we have collected so far this year. That is about $2.8 million in new funding that we believe we'll get from sales tax revenue. We also are looking at some increased revenue from other sources. A lot of this money is funds that are restricted for certain uses. And then we are proposing to use fund balance to balance the budget, and I'll talk about this in a little bit, but I'm recommending that we use a little over $5 million to balance the budget from fund balance this year, and we'll use almost $400,000 in designated funds. And those designated funds we use to pay for some committed economic development infrastructure, as well as retiree health insurance from the LME. So some information about the property tax figures that are in all this information that you have. We have evaluated our property tax base to be over $14.5 billion worth of value that we will be taxing. That is up $584 million from fiscal year 18-19. We're very fortunate to live in a place that continues to see this kind of growth in base value. That's very helpful to us. That's about a 4.17% increase in the base value. Now, our collection rate, as I mentioned a moment ago, we're projecting 98.92% on real and personal property. And on registered motor vehicles, we're projecting 100%. Again, another one of those benefits of the state now taking that on for us. They do take a cut of those funds, but it is a much better collection rate than we've had in the past. Estimated total revenue from property tax is $96.8 million. And for fiscal year 19-20, I'm estimating at 1 cent will equal $1,444,901 in new revenue. So every penny on the property tax rate creates that $1.4 million in revenue. So here's some information about the proposed 8-cent property tax increase. Where will it go? I'm recommending to go from 59 cents to 67 cents. As you can see, 7.04 cents, this is a number that's familiar to the commissioners, is for the capital plan. That will create revenue in the dollar amounts that you see for ABSS and ACC for their part of the capital plan, for their bond projects and their PAYGO dollar amounts. That will create about $8.1 million to go into the capital plan for the school system, and a little over $2 million to go into the capital plan for the community college. I'm also recommending a property tax increase of 0.96 cents. Don't be confused, that is not 9 cents, it is a little less than a penny. That is to go for an equipment plan that was in one of the scenarios that I provided for the board, and I'll touch on it as we move through this presentation. But that 0.96 cents creates an additional $1.3 million in property tax revenue that I'm proposing to use for county equipment. information about sales tax. We are projecting a total amount of revenue in sales tax, $31.7 million. That is, again, 2.4% over our this current fiscal year's anticipated revenue. And what we've seen over the past 5 years is a growth of 7.68% average in actual collected revenue. So we feel like that's a reasonable percentage amount to estimate as an increase for sales tax revenue for next fiscal year. And this chart will show you how we believe these funds will come in. There are several articles that the county collects sales tax under. Some are for the county to do whatever they want to with, the unrestricted pieces. But then there are also pieces that are restricted that are specifically for the school system to use. We're projecting how much revenue should come in under each one of these articles and percentages. And that the restricted pieces that you see there for the school system will be going into the capital plan for the school's bond and PAYGO project. So a little bit of information about what I'm recommending we do with fund balance. I'm recommending that we use a little over $5 million to balance the budget for 19-20. This is a $1.5 million decrease. So I'm recommending that we use approximately $1.5 million less to balance the budget than we did in fiscal year 19-20. The way we're able to do that is this year, as you know, ABSS has turned in a budget request that was flat for their operations. And so, you know, in what we have done for the last year was we estimated 28% of new revenue would be available for the school system. This is an informal policy, strictly a guide for me to try to think about how to estimate dollar amounts for the school. I'm recommending that we take those dollars this year. School systems, as you'll see, the school system's operational requests have been met, that we reduce our use of fund balance. I think that this will be a wise way to use the funding. It doesn't commit it to any new spending, so it will be there in the new revenue next year. So it's a decrease of a little over 30%. We're also budgeting approximately $399,000 worth of designated fund balance for 19-20. That's another decrease of over 50%. The main reason there for that decrease is we had a pot of money that we were using to pay for the LME retirement in coverage when the LME folded up and that responsibility came to the county. We've run, that was all in designated funds. We have run through all that money now and are having to use county dollars. So we just didn't have nearly as much to budget for the LME retirees insurance. So a little bit more information about fund balance. According to our audit from fiscal year 17-18, we had an unassigned fund balance of $20.8 million. That is a 14% fund balance, 14% of our expenditures. It is important to note, out of that $20.8 million, $2.9 million of it has been committed to give to the city of Burlington to help offset the cost of the construction of the new animal shelter. So it's $20.8 million, but we are planning to spend almost three of it for the animal shelter. And this chart gives you an idea of how we have budgeted fund balance from 14-15 all the way to this current year. And then the third column shows you what's happened to fund balance. Did it grow or did we have to use any of it? You can see that in 17-18, we were $780,000 to the good. We are estimating this fiscal year to be $965,000 to the good. That's better than spending fund balance for sure, but that is a very narrow margin when you're talking about $171 million. So I do think this demonstrates the need to reduce our reliance on fund balance to balance the budget. So anyway.
Brian, let me stop you there if you don't mind.
Sure.
The local government, what is it? Local government commission has that 8% deal.
Yes.
Okay, is that 8%? And that 8% has got to be the unassigned or total? Am I saying the words right?
The LGC looks at total fund balance.
Okay, so the 8% is the total, not unassigned, right? What is our total?
I can get that information for you.
Susan will work that up for us. We're really trying very hard to track our fund balance because we found ourselves using it for lots of different purposes, including animal shelter. And I'm going to, when I go over to capital plan information in a few moments, you'll see that we're using a lot of our fund balance that's been designated for different projects. So I'm going to keep going, Susan. You just flag me when you're ready to report that number. The recommended budget also includes fee changes. I always like to try to draw the board's attention to these fee changes so you can take a look at them. In the manager's recommended budget document, the bound document, that you have. The details of this information can be found on pages 5 through 7. These are just highlights, but it is important to note that the inspections department is proposing a fee change. They're going to offer the ability for developers or contractors to request after-hours inspections. So if you have something that you want done after 5 o'clock or perhaps on the weekends, you can request that. There's a little bit higher charge for that. Our hope is, you know, this may help speed projects along. If the developer will have to weigh out, are they willing to pay a little bit more for that after-hours? That covers our cost, but it may help speed their project and save them money in the long run. And we also, the inspections department's also recommended if a set of plans has to be reviewed 3 times, we start increasing our fees. We're hopeful that'll encourage folks to make the needed changes to their plans before they continue to bring them back. The health clinic over at the health department, multiple procedure fees. You can take a look in those pages listed at the bottom to see what those are. Environmental health has multiple fee increases. It is important to note also that the revenue from those fee increases will be used to help cover the cost of several new positions, but particularly the environmental health specialist position that will help us keep our well and septic permitting times low. Our developers are very interested. We have a good time now. I think we're like around 10 days perhaps.
And below 2 weeks, working toward 10 business days.
Which is fantastic. If you look at some of the other jurisdictions around the state, the idea is, of course, to try to help developers speed through their process so they can spend their money wisely too. We also have a recommendation in the proposed budget to increase the landfill tipping fees from $38 per ton to $40 per ton. It's the first time in a long time we've proposed a tipping fee increase, but we're preparing, we are getting ready to open a new cell, and that's going to cost approximately $6-7 million, so we're starting to try to build those funds up. So it seems like it makes sense to consider a $2 per ton landfill tipping fee increase. Next slide just demonstrates the breakdown of the revenue the county is using to balance this budget. The vast majority, almost 57%, is from property taxes, and sales tax is the next highest category of revenue at 18.5%. And then restricted intergovernmental is 12%. That's our third highest, and those are funds that are earmarked specifically from the state or federal government for specific programs, primarily at DSS or maybe the health department too. So this recommended budget has some personnel recommendations. I'm recommending the establishment of 9 new county employee positions, and we'll go through some of the details. You've seen most of these details at the budget retreat. I do want to call attention to the fact that several of these, the two health service planner evaluator positions and the environmental health specialist position, will be covered either with funds from the state or with the increased fees. The DSS attorney is a reimbursed position, I believe at 50 or 65%. We're also reducing some of their contract funding that they've used for to pay for a contract attorney. So it is not an entirely free position, but it is very low cost. The remainder of the positions are general fund positions. The newest one I'm adding is a human resources technician that I'll talk about in just a moment. 9 new positions, 2 reclassifications, reclass for a maintenance position to go from custodian to maintenance worker, and 2 positions in the Department of Social Services. Both are processing assistant 4s. I'm recommending they become income maintenance caseworkers. And we're also recommending the establishment of 3 new career ladders, career ladder for the Board of Elections, the Maintenance Department, and Veteran Service. I don't want to go through too much about these details. I'm happy to answer any questions about them, but I think you've seen this information from the retreat. A lot of these positions, a number of them focus on emergency services. The tax administration position has been a need for the past 2 fiscal years. I think we're getting to a point where we're well over 60, closing in on 90 days for turnarounds for recordation of deeds, and that is way too long. And then the human resources position, I have an item on the agenda today I'm going to talk to you about, our county employee health insurance. But I feel like with the growth of our workforce, the fact that we have a health insurance plan that's over $11 million, that I would really like for the human resources department to take full responsibility of to manage. It's been, in the past, it's been split up between the manager's office, finance department, HR. We've had so many issues with our county employee health insurance program that I feel like adding a resource to HR will help them better maintain that program. Central communications, that shift supervisor position that I'm recommending is a direct recommendation for back. We had a call several months ago, Dorset Street. We brought in some folks to help us analyze CECOM. This was one of the recommendations, so I feel like it will help make sure we've got delineated leadership on the night shift. We're also asking for a quality manager for the EMS department that will work with the medical director and the department's leadership to review our protocols and review how our paramedics do in the field and see if there's any way that we need to improve our training for paramedics. The health department positions, again, environmental health and the human service planners covered by either fees or state funds. And the attorney one for the Department of Social Services is going to be doing away with the contract service piece, making use of reimbursement funds from the state to offset that cost.
Go back to the social services attorney.
Yes.
Can you explain it a little bit for us?
So at the current time, the social service department has one attorney, and then they also have funds in their budget to contract with another attorney to help handle their caseload. It's gotten to the point, my interaction with the Department of Social Service leadership has been that they have so many cases and they're so intricate that they're at a point where they feel like they need two attorneys. This attorney would work for the main attorney that they have. I think that they feel like, and they've communicated to me, having an additional attorney will help them be better prepared for those court cases and make sure they have extra time interviewing children, interviewing families, and preparing their case files. So I tend to agree with them, and I believe that it would fit in this budget.
What other staffing does she have? Jamie, I think, is the county
Jamie Hamm.
Or social services. What kind of staffing do they have in that office?
She has one contract attorney and I believe two paralegals. I'm
just,
not sure.
Just three paralegals.
Three paralegals, one contract assistant, and then Jamie.
That is correct.
Okay.
Now, are the paralegals full-time or?
They are full-time. We have two that primarily does child support and one primarily does child welfare and adult services.
Can we get, brief as quick as possible, a caseload synopsis over the last few years? Not today, but
okay.
You know, like we know what it is this fiscal year, or maybe at the end of last year, fiscal year, and maybe if you could go back 5 years,
okay.
Tell me what that caseload was.
And would you like that for adult services, child welfare?
Whatever
child
they
support?
Have to address.
Yeah. Okay, yes.
Thank you, Adrian. We do have position requests also from the landfill. The landfill fund is separate from the general fund, so it's completely supported by fees and charges that the landfill institute. They're requesting a heavy equipment mechanic. Up until this point, they've been contracting those repairs out, and they believe that they would be better served by having a mechanic on staff stationed at the landfill. And then they're also asking for reclassifications, two positions from landfill attendant to lead landfill attendant, and this is to help provide supervision in the convenience center on the weekends in particular. So a little bit of information about employee compensation and benefits overall. The recommended budget, we continue with our two merit plan program where employees can qualify for up to a 2% raise, but the department has to meet 75% of its performance management goals and the employee has to be evaluated. So they can range from anywhere between no raise to 2% as the highest. So this is the program that we put in place for the first time this fiscal year. It's been very successful, and the recommended budget continues it. Employee health insurance, I'm recommending an additional $584,000 be put into that fund. As you know, we've been in the hole in that fund, approximately $2 million. I'll share some better news with you as we move into some further items on the agenda, but I'm recommending that we continue to increase our funding levels into the health insurance program. And the same applies to dental health and workers' comp. Both of those programs are costing more, so I'm recommending that we're putting a little over $114,000 additional funding into dental health and almost $100,000 into workers' comp. These are additional funds. And this year, we're responding to the state's requirement for the county to contribute more for retirement. So that costs us almost $490,000. This is a mandatory increase from the state. Law enforcement gets a little bit of a different bump than the rest of employees. But again, we had to cover this cost increase. So we'll talk just a moment about, you've heard lots from me about 7.04 cents, education plan, bond projects, capital plan. So what's going to happen with the 0.96 cent property tax increase that I'm recommending in this budget. So what I'm recommending that we do is take the revenue that's created by the 0.96 cent, if you remember, it was about $1.3, almost $1.4 million, and create a capital equipment plans just for county government. That 0.96 cents of that, we would set $930,963 aside. That dollar amount would recur every year. Every year we would plan to buy more capital equipment based on that dollar amount. For this fiscal year, for 1920, you can see the list of the items that I would recommend that we purchase with those dollars. Security system for the maintenance department, a lot of equipment for emergency services, sheriff, EMS, a John Deere Gator for the parks. Then as far as vehicles go, purchasing, I would recommend that we buy our 12 replacement cars. You know, we've done that for a number of years. One thing I'll speak to this as to why I'm interested in recommended that we move to this model is for the past 2 years at least, we've used performance management funds to offset the cost of the sheriff's cars. Those are pretty much exhausted now. So we're at a point where we've committed to the sheriff to continue to try to find him a way to get those 12 cars. That's a little less than 10% of his fleet. So it's reasonable to roll out that number of cars every year to keep his folks driving good quality equipment. And it's the same thing with replacement ambulances and remounts for EMS. It's a good idea for us to have a sustainable plan in place where we are replacing one ambulance every year and we're doing one remount every year. So this plan would do that. And we have a couple of maintenance projects. Our maintenance department has a list of projects that they've received from the courts and county government. Projects that are all under $10,000, those are included here, as well as a specific project at Cedar Rock Park for the Garrett House. So all of these projects would not necessarily be the same next year. If the board approves this 0.96 cent property tax increase, the dollar amount, $930,963, that would be what we would use again next year to think about what we would buy. The sheriff cars would be a solid, that would be recurring. The ambulance would be recurring. These other projects would move around. Yes, sir.
I think it's important here to note too that the sheriff's cars, since we've put those in the budget in the past and looked at those on an annual basis, he can't use the money that he can use from drug forfeiture money for purposes like that if it's already in a budget.
That's true. It's we would appear to the federal government to be supplanting our own budget. This is a recurring piece of our budget that has been for a number of years. So the idea here is to plan. How can we continue to do the things in the operating side of the house that we want to do, but make sure that we can continue to provide these this type of equipment. So think about this equipment plan for county government in two phases. One is a purchase piece, recurs every year. Sheriff, EMS equipment would be recurring every year. There would be some flexibility in the other things that we would buy, other possible cars or projects. The other side of the equipment plan that I'm recommending is a financing piece. This would be funded by the 0.96 cent. We would be looking at approximately $451,000 in financial payments, in debt payments. That would recur every year. The total amount that we would be financing, if this goes through, is a little over $1.5 million for approximately 4 years. I put approximately 4 years because this list also includes the fire marshal's air truck. That's a $375,000 piece of equipment. We may go longer because that's a piece of equipment you're not going to buy maybe every 10 to 15 years. So we might would stretch the financing out on it. But the rest of these things, number of vehicles, much of it is vehicles for tax, vehicles for IT, new dump truck for the maintenance department, inspections, a new vehicle, a medic truck for EMS, replacement vehicles for DSS. We would buy these things that are on this list. In particular, the CCOM projects need to be done. Fire and EMS are having problems out in the county receiving their pages. FCC had us turn down the strength of our VHF signal a number of years ago, and it's making it very difficult for them to get their pages all over Alamance County. We need to install a second transmitter so we can cover more territory with that lower frequency. So I'm recommending that we would finance that equipment and backup equipment for that use in CCOM. So,
Mr. Hager, you were talking about adding the shift supervisor to CCOM as being one of the recommendations that came out of the consultant or
yes.
group. Was is that are those two items related to that same report, or are those?
I don't believe these were specific recommendations, but this is our fire folks have made it very clear to us that if they miss a page, it could lead to them not having staff on a scene. So I can't remember off the top of my head if that's in the report, but if not, it may be because it resurfaced after the report had already been done. I would say that adding this equipment, the VHF transmitter and the backup equipment are some of the most important piece of this budget. We want to make sure that fire and EMS can hear their pages and know where to go.
What part of the county is that?
We'd be looking in the northern part of the county. I think we've identified an area in the Five Points area that we would put this.
I just want to emphasize that too, because I had a contact from somebody who's involved in the emergency services arena for the entire county, and who's from the Five Points general area. And there was a need to bring in specialized equipment, and they needed somebody on the ground to help facilitate that. And this person didn't get the page. They paged this person four times, and they didn't get it, so they weren't, somebody's laying there, really suffering. And I just think that is a big priority for the county to make sure that in 2019, we should be able to get emergency services where they need to be.
Yes.
And people should be able to talk to each other.
Yes, I agree. And I think you're looking at around $800,000 worth of equipment needs. That's difficult to fit into a budget. However, fitting it into a finance plan where we're making payments on that is a four-year plan. So in 4 years, we would be looking at a new list of things to finance. It could be another tower somewhere else in the county. It would be more than likely vehicles for some of our other departments. I hope I'm conveying this clearly. My goal is to, if the board approves this 0.96 cent, is to establish this dollar amount of $1.3 million to always be in place for capital. $960,000 for purchase power, $450,000 for financing. Financing happens every 4 years as we pay these things off. So. And one other piece to the financing plan. This is not part of the 0.96 cents. This is coming over from the operating side of the house. We have budgeted in the budget that you have $150,000 for Alamance County Rescue Debt Service. That $150,000, $100,000 of it is new funds. We would reallocate $50,000 from our current contribution that we give them. So we would have $150,000 for debt. That would give us over, if we financed Rescue. Rescue's made it very clear to the board and to staff that one of their biggest needs is equipment. They have a lot of aging equipment, in particular a crash truck, very expensive piece of equipment, $700,000-$800,000 at least. It's very difficult for them to raise the funding to do that. What I'm proposing is the county, instead of Rescue trying to do fundraisers to create that money to buy an $800,000 truck, the county would budget $150,000 for payments. We would finance a crash truck and whatever else we could finance for them over a 10-year period. That would give us a little over $1 million in purchase power. That's what we're estimating. So the county would finance it. The county would make the payments. I would suggest that it would be wise for the county to retain ownership of that equipment, but through an agreement or our contract. Rescue is the group that uses that equipment. So our hope would be this would free Rescue up from having to worry about how to replace this equipment and focus on operations. Right. Yes.
Do you know if the Rescue people are on board with that? I assume that they have heard this.
I think some of the commissioners have talked more with them about this particular plan. This was the result of a long and many conversations, as the board knows.
They said they would like to see that. Yeah, they're in favor of it.
They really like this proposal.
Yeah.
We discussed it last week.
So also some capital needs for our landfill. Again, this is from the enterprise fund, from the landfill itself, not from general fund. The landfill is proposing to spend $614,000 on capital. That is for a road tractor and a F-550 pickup, dump truck type truck, a new convenience center ticket booth, and some other improvement dumpsters and some paving projects that they need to do. These funds come from the landfill enterprise fund. A little information about debt service. Our current outstanding principal as of July 1 is a little over $45 million, and you can see in this chart how that breaks down. the county's debt that exists right now today, Alamance Berlin School System and the community college. You can see how those debts fall out. The payment that is budgeted for the fiscal year 1920 is almost $9 million. And then you can see how that $9 million payment breaks down between the county's debt, Alamance Burlington's school system's debt, and the community college's debt. All this is encapsulated in our capital plan, in our bond and education bond plan. Our legal debt margin is a little over $1 billion, which the board has set policy that really reduces that down to about $420 million. So that's just our absolute max out possible debt, but not by our own policies, of course. So let's talk just a moment about Alamance Burlington School System, what the recommended budget includes. I'm recommending for operations that the school system receive a funding level of $42,463,142. This is the dollar amount requested by the school system. And then for capital outlay, I'm recommending that the school system receive $3.3 million in capital outlay, their PAYGO money. Again, that money is in our big overall 7.04 cent plan. Of that, you can see how that $3.3 million is made up, a little over $1 million in lottery funds and $2.2 million in dedicated sales tax. So the total recommended dollar amount for Alamance Burlington School System for 1920 is $45.7 million. I made a point last year of trying to think about this new revenue idea. How do you project how much of new revenue that's not tax increase oriented should the school system get? This year, the dollar amount was $1.5 million, and those are the dollars that I'm recommending we reduce our fund balance usage by. Again, I think that puts us in a good place with fund balance, and it ensures that those monies are not put into a budget and spent, then thus much more difficult to get back next year, because I expect the school system to probably have some requests again next year. So,
before you go on from that slide, I just wanted to ask one thing. For the capital outlay PAYGO, $3.3 million, that's the school system, their operating request was flat, as you mentioned earlier. But that capital outlay represents a $1.3 million increase over what they received last year, and in addition to paying for the bonds, right?
That's correct.
So if the citizens are thinking, well, the county didn't budget anything extra for the school system this year, that would not be correct. Not only are we paying for the bonds, but they're also getting $1.3 million more to do maintenance and upkeep on the school system to address those facility needs other than what's already being addressed by the bonds, right?
Yes, that is correct. It's an important point. Originally, our bond plan discussions with the school system, the amount of PAYGO was going to be about $2.2 million, and the schools have indicated that this $3.3 amount will, along with the bonds, will really help them make a difference. So I'm recommending that we do that. That is a part of the 7.04 cent recommended tax increase, but yes, indeed.
So when people are worried about mold in the schools or roofs or leaking, water damage, bad windows, whatever, they need to know that this board has allocated $1.3 million more to fixing up those problems than was done last year.
That's correct, yes. And I will say, if the board adopts the 7.04 cent plan to implement bonds and the PAYGO plan for school system and community college, we really will have gone a long way to setting up a program that for the next 7 years we will be doing a lot to help the school system and the community college. So I hope the public will understand that. I think it's an important point to note that $3.3 million is more than we had originally planned. But again, I have to tip my hat to the schools and the community college. They have done as we asked. They have given us a seven-year plan that shows how they are going to spend the money that I'll talk about in a moment when we do our facility plan, that we're going to make efforts as staff to make sure the public sees that and understands that these groups have plans and are working on them, and the county is fulfilling its responsibility to help fund them. So
I believe that a lot of those funds in the PAYGO plan are related to school safety, if
yes.
I remember correctly, that's not all school safety, but there are aspects of school safety involved in that $1.3 million. I'm sorry, Mr.
No.
Couple of years ago, maybe last year, I'm not sure, but you made a motion to increase the what we were giving. We giving them $800,000 every year or something, and then we took it to a million.
That's right.
Is that the same line item that we're going even another million?
Yes. They will have, if the board goes with the recommended budget, all bond projects for ABSS and the school system, excuse me, the community college, on the top would be funded on the timelines that they projected. And the school system would get $3.3 million every year to help tackle non-bond projects, too. Mm-hmm. And in that capital plan, they have provided what they will do with that $3.3 million for the next 7 years.
But what I'm trying to get down, and I've been meaning to ask this question, we were at $800,000, best of my memory, on that line item, and then we took it higher when we voted on the budget. If I'm not mistaken.
Yes, I think the board added half $1 million to it, I believe.
Yeah, it was
a half a million.
Mm-hmm. I believe
so. So that took it to 1.3, right? Mm-hmm.
No, it was 750, and no. I think we took it to an even million.
We did.
Okay. I thought it was that. Okay. So the million that we were at, now it's what? Give me that figure one more time.
3.3 million.
3.3.
Yes, sir. Okay.
How long had we done the 750?
We've been all over the place with our PAYGO amounts. We've ranged from, I don't have that list with me, but we've had $500,000. There have been a number of years where we didn't do any. We were down around 200,000. We can provide that information for you.
Obviously a significant increase.
Yes, yeah. Indeed. Yeah. Indeed.
And if it's kept, you know, finite or, you know, I mean, or higher, yeah, you know, I mean, just don't go lower. I mean, I don't see how anybody can complain about that. But,
is any of this going to move us in the schools toward a single point of lockdown to create a situation where we can close up the schools if we see an active shooter situation?
Yes, sir. The safety piece that we showed over the next 4 years,
right,
is to increase safety dramatically, excuse me, in the schools. So as far as like safety vestibules, automatic locking doors, key cards, more camera systems, better upgraded camera systems. So we're trying to cover the whole gamma over a 4 year period in all our schools.
It always bothers me that they pick up a license plate from a satellite, but we can't get a clear picture of somebody walking into the building.
And that's going to be one of the things we've upgraded the cameras, the technology in cameras now. It's just amazing.
I think it's been one of the best things that's come out of all this preparation for the vote on the bond projects, as well as the post-vote discussions, is county staff, community college staff, and the school system staff have really engaged. We're very much aware of the projects that they are proposing. I feel like our role is to ensure that we communicate that to you, and you know what their projects are. You have access to their project lists, to the progress that that they're making, as well as the public. So. And both groups have been very cooperative today. So.
Also, I'm sorry, you keep trying to get off the slide.
No, it's okay. Right? It's all right. Any questions, please?
I just want to make a quick statement about this allocating the 28% of the property tax and setting that aside in fund balance for this year with the anticipation that it may be needed for the school system next year. I really like that idea because, for one, we need to increase our fund balance and decrease our reliance on using that for budgeting. I understand that. And also, I think I spoke a couple meetings ago about my concern about continually chasing what the General Assembly does. When the General Assembly increases teacher pay, our local supplement, the dollar amounts go up in our support of that, or our commitment to that. And it creates a situation where we're continually, you know, if I remember right, last year's budget, the continuation request just to cover the increase in salary from the General Assembly and our matching local supplement plus retirement plus health insurance, it was like $1.6 million or $1.8 million, something like that. And then this year it would have been $2.9 million if the school system hadn't found ways to make adjustments within their budget to cover for that. So this, you go from 1.6 to 2.9. Good grief, what's it going to be next year? You know,
based on what the General Assembly does.
Yeah, based on the General Assembly and what they decide to do. So I think that taking a longer view, and I can see a lot of the long view taken in this budget, which I really like
that too.
You really are looking at things projecting out instead of putting out fires today you're looking at what the needs are likely to be longer term. I think that's great, and I think this is an aspect of that where we're planning. We know that there may be changes needed, and we're anticipating those instead of reacting.
Indeed, yes. Thank you.
Before you leave that slide, in regards to Commissioner Sutton's question, in fiscal year 2017, we had allocated $250,000 for the capital outlay for the school system. In the 2018 budget, it was recommended to increase that to $500,000. The board voted to increase that to $1 million, and they were funded at $1 million for 18 as well as fiscal year 19.
Thank you.
What was that fund balance?
I do have that information. So our total fund balance for the general fund is $48.7 million, which equates to 32.6% of our fiscal year 18 expenditures. Our available fund balance is 21.8%, which looks at unassigned as well as assigned. The LGC looks at that grouping for the available fund balance because they feel that if we have already committed things and reserved by state statute, that it's not fallen into that. So that would be the 21.8%. And then the portion that is completely unassigned, meaning that the board has not given it any specific reason for it to be used by, is 14%.
Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome.
I'm going to go ahead and move on to the community college. So I'm recommending for the community college that the operational funding level be $3,464,312. And their PAYGO dollar amount, their funding that they will be able to use on non-bond related projects per the capital plan, $870,000. Total recommended allocation for the community college, $4,334,312. So this is right in line with our capital plan. The $870,000 is a significant increase from $440,000 that we did in 18-19, but that was communicated to us as their need. So first year of the capital plan, $870,000. And it's also good to note here, and I'll be sure I call attention to this, for the, you know, last year, for the, this year, excuse me, 18-19, for the community college, we figured 2%. Right, we said they were approximately 2% of our overall budget. So if you're trying to think about how to allocate just new revenue, not from a tax increase, the community college is reasonable to consider giving them 2%. So for 2% of new revenue without including the tax increases is $113,668. I will say that I'm recommending that we fund their entire operating request. So they would be receiving an additional $164,973 for this fiscal year. So the $113,000 was very close to their entire operating request. So my recommendation is to fund the community. This will probably be the first time in many years that the school system and the community college have both received what they requested in operations and what they've requested in capital. That doesn't happen very often. So appreciate their work with us to help make that possible. Outside agencies request, the total dollar amount is a little over $3.2 million. It is important to note of that $3.2 million, $2.2 of it are grant funds, state funds, federal funds, just pass-through monies. Not quite $1 million is county funding. I'm holding all outside agencies to the 18-19 level with three exceptions. I am recommending a 2% increase to Meals on Wheels, Alamance Elder Care, and Family Abuse Services. They have been held at their, they've been held for a number of years, so I am recommending they get a 2% increase. That is about $3,500 extra county dollars, so it's a minimal impact.
Which ones were those again?
Meals on Wheels, Alamance Elder Care, and Family Abuse Services. These are all nonprofits that they receive grant funding through us. They use our funding as a match, so I haven't recommended an increase for them in a number of years. So 2%, it's less than $4,000. I felt like that was a reasonable thing to recommend. And you can see the dollar amounts recommended for each of our other outside agencies. So.
I thought that we gave the rescue squad $100,000. Did I have that wrong in my head, or is that?
No, that is correct. I'm recommending $50,000 in cash. We normally give them $100,000 in cash with a string on it that $50,000 is for paying their staff. They have indicated in the past that that can cause some problems for them. We've been very firm to say you have to use it to pay staff. I'm saying we give them $50,000 in cash, take that $50,000 that we normally give them for their staff, put it with the new $100,000 toward the financing piece. So overall, they're getting $200,000.
Right.
Thank you.
It's just not showing up here.
A little bit of information about occupancy tax. The total recommended dollar amount of occupancy tax that will be available is a little over $885,000. That is after the county takes its 3% for administering this program. So the county share is $295,000. The TDA will receive $590,407. And you can see how I'm recommending that we break down the county share. A little over $28,000 for Cultural Arts Center, African American Cultural Arts. A little over $90,000 for the Alamance County Arts Association, $81,000 plus for the Textile Heritage Museum, and $95,106 for the Historic Museum. Susan, I don't believe that this was the dollar amounts that they all requested. I think they're a little bit short in each one. Is that right? I can't remember. It's very close for a couple of them, but this seemed like the reasonable way to break down the dollars.
Brian, on the textile mill, is that covering the person that we added recently?
Yes.
To that.
That is.
So the agency in that grouping that would receive a little bit more than what was requested would be the Historical Museum. Their request was at $93,973, and when we allocated it out based on percentage, his percent would bring him to $95,100.
So we used the how they fell in percentage of the budget to allocate the dollars to them, so the Historic Museum winds up getting a little bit more money than they asked for originally.
What were the requested amounts on the other three?
Let's see, for the Arts Council, they had requested $100,000. For the African American Cultural Arts Museum, $95,000. And for the Glencoe Textile Museum, they had requested $85,000.
What do we do for the African Museum?
$28,306.
So they received, I think they received $25,000 last year, so they received an increase of $3,300. So this, and again, we used just percentages to work this out.
Let me ask, so Textile Museum, I think Eddie just asked this about, that includes having a Parks and Rec person in the Textile Museum. So that's a county employee.
Yes.
Who's working in the Textile Museum. And that's included in the $81,000.
Yes, that's correct.
Part of the cost of doing that. And to your knowledge, the Arts Association, the Historic Museum, are we supporting staff in those? How do they use that? If I remember right, the Historic Museum from their presentation to the board last week, or whenever it was, they were talking about some needs for buildings, mm-hmm. for fixing up some structures that they were going to use the money for. Do we remember for the other categories how, if we're essentially underwriting their paychecks?
I think Susan must be looking up at their request, so we'll get that information for you. I don't know off the top of my head, but I think they would have outlined that in their budget request. So we'll get it for you here in just a moment.
Thank you.
And next slide just gives you a breakdown of how the county's proposing to spend dollars. Education is receiving a little over 29%. Public safety coming in the second highest at 22.8%. And then health human services at 19.45%. We're recommending one change to the budget ordinance that's already incorporated in. Basically, this has to do with our requirement for financial statements and for audits from groups that we fund. What we're saying is any agency that we fund in excess of $5,000 is going to at least give us an annual financial statement, and we also reserve the right to require an audit. So we have some groups that give us audits every year, and we have some that we fund very small amounts, and an audit might cost maybe more than we give them, or significant, almost all we give them. So we would at least want to see financial statements from each group. But even if it's a group that we receive financial statements from, if we have reason to believe that we need an audit, the ordinance would give staff the ability to request it. That is a change from
the previous one. I think that's a good idea.
I think that's a good idea, too. And I'd like to also say that I have concerns about funding independent organizations with taxpayer money. And we have the power to tax. We put our hand in somebody's pocket and we take the money out of it, whether they like it or not. And then we're handing it over to another organization. If it's not part of county government already, that we have a significant amount of oversight for. And I have concerns about allocating taxpayer money to independent organizations with relatively little oversight over what they do with the funds. And one of those concerns is paying people salaries to do stuff. I think that we should, as a board, if we're going to increase our funding of independent organizations, look at what kind, maybe it should only be a certain percentage of their overall operating budget, or, you know, if it passes a certain threshold, then we should take a look at whether or not that organization should be incorporated into an already existing part of county government, or, you know, what other opportunities that organization is pursuing in fundraising. And I'm not thinking about or talking about any one organization in mind when I say that. I just think that as a governing board, we have an enormous responsibility to make sure that the taxpayers' dollars are going to fund things that are logically required or needed by government, and not, you know, other stuff.
That's well stated. I agree with that.
Yeah, I do too.
And that would be something beneficial, I think, for us to work on for through next fiscal year, is maybe coming up with some kind of policy statements for the board to give staff some guidance. So we make sure if we're communicating to these nonprofits and outside groups what you can expect when you apply. We have some criteria. We like to see different funding sources, so it's not just we're 100% reliant on county government. Usually the stronger nonprofits do that. They've got funds coming in from all over. The county's just a piece. That's what we like to see. If you start getting to where the county is the only group funding your nonprofit, that's a little bit, that could mean maybe you're not relevant in the community anymore, or maybe the county should consider, is this something we should just be doing or not? So yeah, I agree with your statement, and that will give us some food for thought for next fiscal year too.
A good thing about a lot of them are that they do bring income into the county too. Sure. With what they do, and as far as tourism and
that's right,
those kind of things. So I think you have to look at the overall picture, not just who's getting paid and all that. But
absolutely. Yeah. I think it's a complex question, but I think it would be good to have some thought put into it and maybe come up with some policies so that the public understands how the county approaches those decisions. And also, so that people who are thinking about applying can have some guidance about what to expect. And people are treated fairly relative to one another.
Yes, indeed. That would be helpful as a staff, because again, this year our allocation method was percent of budget, just because it's very difficult for the staff to just start weighing out which of these causes and programs are more important. I mean, we have some thought about that, but you know, we try to be fair too. So I think having some more well-developed policies that give guidance for applications and for funding would be very
well helpful. Now, these are basically funds coming from the tourism development group, so
yes,
these are incomes that are brought in because of tourism.
Yes.
We're just turning around and paying them, or giving them, not paying them.
That's right.
Them the funds.
They're supporting.
Yes.
We support what they do.
Right.
Yeah.
So at this point, just touch on the volunteer fire departments. We have not received any requests for a tax increase by any fire district. So we're not expecting, there's no recommendation for any tax increases for any fire district. The total budget for county fire for fiscal year 1920 is a little over $5.4 million.
That's the first time in.
No, last
year. Did they do it last year?
We didn't have one last year.
Huh? Nobody requested?
We didn't give them too much 2 years ago, Tim.
Well, anyway, that's still one of the first.
That's good, isn't it?
Yes.
You know, I want to say something about who we support. You know, I don't think it's mandated that we have that we do the library, is it?
No, there's no.
Yeah, I mean, there's certain things you do aesthetically and culturally, and you know, I think there's a waste in certain areas possibly, but you know, there's several things that we do that we don't have to do, and I'm glad we do it. Yeah, you know,
sure.
I've always been a big
public benefit.
Our library is very, very impressive, and I don't think it's excessive, and so I think you got to weigh each case and see exactly what is the aesthetic and the cultural advantage to having the museum or the African American cultural museum, whatever. You know, I'm not as hard on it as you might think I would be.
Sure.
But
Well, I think that's the end of the information that I have to present to you about the manager's recommended budget. It might be easier if we email you or get you this information that the chair requested about the breakdown of salaries and how the funds for occupancy tax play out. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them. I hope you've got all the information that I have for you to review at any time between now and when the board will vote. Please do not hesitate to contact me or any of our staff if you have questions about this. Again, we'll be posting this information on the county's website for everybody to review. So if you don't have any questions.
I have one.
Yes, sir.
Go back to page 3, if you would. Now, I know you've explained it, and the numbers are there. But, you know, we're riding down the road together. We're just shooting the bull, and I look at you, and I say, our general fund in 17-18 was 147.7, if I'm correct. 18-19, 152.3. Now it's at 171.7, right?
Yes.
And I just would say, and you see the gap. One-year gap alone totaled the two. Because two fiscal years is not a long time.
Sir.
In lay terms, ballpark, quick answer, how would you fill in that gap?
So if you take that $171 million figure, and you take out the $11.8 million, because that is strictly for this new capital bond and education project fund, that takes you down to about $160 million. That is roughly our operating budget, if I'm not speaking incorrectly. But even another million of that is the 0.96 cent that's above the 7.04. So we're about $159 million roughly for county operating budget. And that is the new revenue growth. Out of the scenarios that I sent, one was a new revenue growth scenario. I think it was around close to $6 million. So what we have budgeted at all, with the exception of $1.5 million, we've put that back in fund balance. So new revenues coming in without a tax increase, that is the truth, not in an amount great enough to fund this capital project that we have. But we're very fortunate that base is growing and that we're bringing in more sales tax revenue and property tax revenue. So
good answer. I won't mention here, but we used to have somebody that sat up here and give us heck for our increase. And without pulling out sheets of paper, I could name every major thing that's come along that just brought us to where we were. And he would shut up. He wouldn't say nothing else. But anyway, that was a good answer. I like that.
Okay. Well, we need to set a public hearing for May 20th at 7 p.m.
I'll make a motion that we do that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to set a public hearing on the budget ordinance for fiscal year 2019-2020. I think that's the next item on the agenda is in place. So okay. The public hearing would be May 20th, 2019 at 7 p.m. We have a motion and a second. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And then we need to change the location of the meeting to Cummings High School. Let's see, in 2017, we did it at Williams. 2018, we did it at Southern. And this year, the school system has graciously worked with us on coming up with an idea to do it at Cummings. I don't know what y'all think of that. If you want to do it at Cummings, or see about another location.
Is the school system good with that? I guess we've already checked.
So we have a motion and a second to change the meeting location on May 20th to Cummings High School in Burlington. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. It's been an hour and a half, so let's have a recess. What do y'all think?
Good idea.
Let's have a 10-minute recess, please. Returning to our agenda, the next item is the Alamance County Facility Plan Review. Mr. Haygood again.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm going to go through some information about facility planning process and some of the results that we've come back with. Out of respect for time, I'm going to try to go quickly, but I'm going to give this justice because there's been a lot of effort put into this plan and process, a lot of folks working on it. It does touch on county government, court system. It has an element for the school system and for the community college also. And a lot of it, I don't have a hard copy for you. We're really going to try to use internet and web-based ways to communicate this to the public. So you'll have to kind of look at the two screens. And this will all be posted online later on today. It's important to think about what we were facing, what we are facing with our facility needs. The reason we took this planning process on, we have issues with our own county government and court building conditions. We also have the population of Alamance County is growing steadily, and that means we have more and more folks coming into our buildings and demanding our services. And we also felt like it was a good idea to plan for the future when it comes to county buildings, court buildings, as well as schools and community college. So what have we accomplished through this facility plan and process? It's been a little over a year that we've been doing this work. One of the main things that has come out of it that I think really demonstrated the need for the plan process in the first place is we have demolished over 70,000 square feet of buildings that were F grade. Just absolutely. So we had in our inventory 70,000 square feet of properties that we are much better off having demoed. And that, while not necessarily a recommendation or an action item out of this plan, those were decisions made throughout the planning process. So the HSC Training Center, the Cronodal Building, Red Street Building, Woody Drive, over off the interstate and the South Annex, these were all buildings that were just in such poor shape that we were better off tearing them down. So it's certainly worthwhile to do this facility plan process. It's given us the opportunity to assess the remaining county buildings and court buildings for what should be repaired, what should be replaced. We've also taken this opportunity of planning to meet with county and court staff to get a space needs assessment, talk to them about how you're using your space now, how you see your space needs in the future. And as I mentioned during the budget presentation, we use this as an opportunity to get that assessment information and establish a 7-year capital plan for county government, which I'll show you here in just a moment. One of the more interesting pieces that I'm going to show you is a conceptual plan for our three county campuses. It'll give you an idea of what the future of county buildings and their placement could look like, and also a means to communicate all of this information to the public. And this, I'll talk about this in a moment, we're going to use this format and this look via the internet to communicate our county and court capital needs and progress, as well as the school system and the community college. There is no vote involved in this today. We have this process will be dynamic. It's going to continue, but there's no need to vote to approve. We're just going to start working toward the goals that I'm going to go over. So you can see here, this is the look that we've adopted for how to communicate this information to the public. We're going to start off talking about our 7-year CIP for county government that has come out of, and this is in the capital plan that you have too. So I know this is small on the screen, but all this information is in the capital plan. We developed this 7-year list working with the buildings assessment information that we got back from our capital planning process. It's in the capital plan. I think what's interesting to note is that in fiscal year 1920, that's the year we're about to go into, the capital plan that you have, the big bound version, is including $14 million for county government and court projects. That is $14 million that we will have, that I am saying to you that we will have. Of that $14 million for next fiscal year, about $5 million of it will be obtained in an installment loan that we have debt capacity for, because we're doing the big capital plan. School system has a piece, community college has a piece, county government has a piece, separate pieces. In our piece of that, as we pay down debt, we're going to be able to borrow an additional $5 million next year to do repair work all across county government, which is all outlined in this big list. We also have, in 1920, part of that $14 million is $3 million that we're planning to borrow to finance voting machinery, that, my understanding is that may be delayed a little bit longer. There's work afoot in Raleigh to delay the need to purchase voting equipment, but that debt is still in there, and we'll just keep moving it from year to year until it's time for us to buy it. We're also looking at, in our CIP plan, making our $2.9 million contribution to the animal shelter, and the final piece of the $14 million that we believe we'll be spending next fiscal year is for the building that we partnered with Mr. Petrie to build over behind HSC. That's to house DSS, Friendship Adult Day, and the Open Door Clinic. So the CIP plan is a part of the capital plan. It's been a good product. It's given us 7 years worth of costs and projects to do, and it's been a direct result of our facility planning process. And we'll be working with, so we have a 7-year plan, so does the community college and school system. And in our capital plan, we say that we will be meeting regularly with the school system and community college via these TRC meetings, talk with them about progress that we're making. And I think what you're going to see very soon after July 1 is I'm going to be before you requesting that two commissioners be assigned to this oversight committee. And that would meet with representation from the school system, Board of Education, and possibly someone from the Board of Trustees, LACC, that our TRC groups would report to regularly. And then that information could be brought back to the board. So one good product was our CIP. I think the next piece I'm interested in demonstrating to you is our communication part of the facility plan. So we're going to take a look at how we're going to use this plan. And it's not a plan in front of you. I keep saying plan. It's really web-based information that we feel like will be much easier for the public and staff to access. So we're putting all the county and the courts and the school system capital into one place, easy to access. When you look at the county information, you're going to see you can access building specs, floor plans, the space need information from each county department is in here. ABSS information is going to be included, and I'll show you an example of that. That is bond and non-bond projects, as well as bond and non-bond projects for the community college. So if we could start off, Michelle, and show the commissioners the county office building information just as an example of county buildings. So here's that page there was just a list of all county buildings. You could click on each county building, pull up a picture of the building, all the pertinent details about our building. In fact, you can see floor plans, I believe, in this one of the county office building. So we've loaded all our floor plans. This is all very helpful for our maintenance folks. If we're contracting work, we've got them all loaded for every county building, loaded up, easy to find, easy to see.
I have two questions.
Yes.
For one, did we do a, is this thing right here, is this an in-house product, or do we have a consultant who assisted in all of this?
That's an in-house product.
This is amazing.
I have to say,
I'm
yes.
Blown away right now.
I don't want to short sell the capital plan. Yes, it was put together. This bound document that you have was put together with county staff, community college staff, and the school system staff. Lots of work. It was. We looked at examples from facilities in Virginia as well as Chatham County and some other North Carolina counties to come up with this format and template. So yes, I don't want to sell it short. This was done in-house. The facility planning process, some conceptual stuff that you're going to see, the building assessments where people went out and did detailed looks at our systems, that was done with outside help. So.
Now I have another question about this. The floor plans for the buildings, will that be available to the public?
No.
Wouldn't that be a safety concern if somebody had some kind of...
Same question, yeah.
Yes.
Some kind of malice... for evil intent, then they would be able to plan out how they would want to carry out an attack. So that's not going to be available.
No, we will limit the amount of information and the types of information that are put out through the website for the public. Most of it will be the ability for them to see the project plans, the project costs, progress that ourselves and the other groups are making on their projects. That's primarily what it is. The conceptual stuff that I'll show you in a moment, that will be out there so they can, the public can see it. But this behind the scenes kind of stuff, I just wanted to demonstrate to you that from internal staff working perspective, to have all this in one place, we've never had that before, to have at your fingertips to pull this kind of information up is extremely helpful. So that's an excellent point. So for the county office building, We also will be able to have the list of projects that are needed for the county office building, and each one of our buildings will have the same info. So you can see for county government, for county buildings, we'll have what projects are needed. We need to, we've completed the ceiling project of the outside wall, elevator project. We have HVAC system, which we need desperately. I think came in this morning and the chiller was out of whack. So we have timelines for when those will be addressed and the dollar amounts, and that will be for every county buildings. We'll jump over to the J.B. Allen Courthouse. So I can show you that we've done this for county buildings as well as for court buildings, because we're responsible for those also. So if we could show just the capital project list for the J.B. Allen Courthouse. So for the courthouse, we have for next fiscal year, 1920, we're going to do foundation work. We have foundation is giving us a problem at the J.B. Allen Courthouse, and we're also planning to replace the roof in next fiscal year's budget. Those would be part of the dollars that we would be borrowing to do that. So, example of the county government, example of plans for the courthouse. Let's take a look at the school system, Alamance-Burnham School System pages next. So for Alamance-Burnham School System, they're another one of our responsibilities, obviously. We've worked with the schools to put together information about each school, and we are listing projects that are planned either as part of the bond project or part of non-bond project seven-year CIP. So let's show a bond project page, and let's go look at Southern High School and look at a bond. So this information will all be available to the public, right? So they will be able to click on this and say, and go to the county's website, pull this piece up, look at their particular high school. If they have a child that goes to Southern High School, they would be able to click on Southern and see this information that is the proposed bond project information for the school. We also have a page that is for the non-bond project information, which I think we would go to E.M. Holt Elementary School to see those. So for E.M. Holt, the school system is planning to replace the roof at E.M. Holt. Folks there that have kids can see that that is the plan. And one thing to note, a caveat with all of these capital plans, they can change. If something happens that is more dire than elevator replacement at county office building, for example, or some work that the school is planning or the community college is planning, if something happens that's more disastrous, we always, of course, reserve the right to change these. But now that we meet in these TRC meetings every week, we'll have that ability to talk. We'll be able to come back and make those changes too. So the main thing I wanted you to take away is for the school system, we'll be looking and reporting on bond projects as well as non-bond projects. We can take a look also at the community college. We have pages for the community college bond projects. And I think we were going to look at the Student Learning Center. So for the public, they'll be able to look at the information about the community college's bond projects. This one in particular is for the Student Learning Center. They can see the dollar amounts and the information about it. And then we also have developed this form that will be posted on each school system page and community college page that is a progress report. So if the bonds happen, we'll be meeting regularly with both staffs. We'll be getting this information from both staffs. We'll come back, update this, and put it out for public consumption so people can see how money is being spent, how projects are coming along, if any changes are being made. Yes, sir.
And we do have money allocated in the bond, I believe, for somebody to manage construction, sure the draws are done, or that we're advancing when work is actually completed, to our satisfaction, right?
Yes, I believe the school system has addressed that and will be doing it through their budget. And the community college is looking at, is it bond proceeds? To bring in folks to help them do that. So, yeah.
Yeah, one of the good things about that is to make sure people don't steal as it goes up. It happens.
Yes.
It happens when we were changing things at the whole hospital, mm-hmm. the health department.
Yeah, it's very important that the owner has a representative on the ground, keeping up with change orders, making sure that everything is being done to their spec.
Yeah, somebody went in there and stole all the copper pipe. If y'all remember.
Well, I think this having a place that we can report progress on the bond projects will be very helpful for the public to see that information. So my understanding from the school system and the community college is they will also link to this information once we get it posted. Both groups will link from their website, so we'll all, you know, citizen going to any one of the three pages, county, school system, or community college, will be able to come here and see all this information about myriads of capital projects. Another result that's come out of this facility planning process, and this is probably a little of the more exciting stuff from county government's perspective, is I'm going to talk to you a little bit about conceptual plans for county and court properties. So what we've tried to do during this year-long process is think about what does the future hold for county government buildings and for the court buildings. How do we foresee in coming years the best use of our land, our properties, our buildings? How can we limit the cost for the future growth that we know Alamance County is going to have? We know that the county is growing. We know that there are more people moving here. There's going to be more demands for court services and county government services. How do you manage that, plan for that, but keep costs down? One of the main decisions that we came to during this facility plan process was we need to make the absolute, or plan to make the absolute best use out of the property that we currently own. Right? We own a lot of land. We have a lot of capacity on our properties. So our thought was, let's look at what would county properties look like if they were fully maxed out eventually, so we don't make any decisions that limits our capacity in the future. So we've looked at three campuses. County government breaks down into three campuses: Graham, downtown, Martin Street, over at the corner, Martin Street, Graham, Hopedale Road, and the HSC campus. I'm going to briefly talk about each one of them and show you what we think is going to develop on each site. So let's start with the Graham campus. You can see an overview here of downtown Graham, the historic courthouse there, kind of in the right centerpiece, county office building there on the corner of Elm and Maple, and then you've got our big, giant piece of property right across the street. Right? We have a very large lot right across the street that's, for the most part, pretty undeveloped. So we started off in this facility plan process thinking we can pretty much figure that courts are going to stay in downtown Graham. Court system, courts, rooms, those things have been in Graham for years and years and are going to stay here, but they are growing. They are pretty much maxed out with what they have right now. So how do we address these issues, and how do we address the county piece too? So if you can zoom in on the lot across the street. So here we go. This is what we foresee as how the county government could build out a lot across the road to accommodate future court needs and some county government needs too. Now the first building, you can see there's the new jail, the old jail, and the existing criminal court buildings. Those are already on site. Everything in yellow, orange is new possibilities for the county to construct. So let's zero in on the next screen. So there's the existing criminal court building. That building was built, I believe, in 1996. It's pretty well full when it opened up. Lots of folks moved in. My understanding, what I've always heard and what I understand, is that's only half the original building that was proposed to be built. So we've been, for a number of years now, making use of it. We've got court in that building. That's J.B. Allen. We have court there. We have court in the civil court building right beside of us. And we have court that occurs up in the historic courthouse. One of the first things that we foresee happening in this facility plan is the construction of an office addition beside the criminal courts building. So now this office building would basically be the new building that would house the district attorney, all the judges, almost all of the clerk's office, juvenile justice, who we're going to talk about later on in this meeting, as well as the sheriff's department, civil folks, and possibly, who knows who else could go in there, probation, parole, possibly CSI. If we built that building, the office addition, what would that allow us to do? It would allow us to move everybody out of existing criminal courts, all the staff, all the offices. The existing criminal court currently has, I believe, three courtrooms. But the way it was designed is all the spaces that the offices are in are the same dimensions of courtrooms. So if you moved the judges, the district attorney, the clerk, all those staff out into another section, that office addition, you would then be able to go into the criminal courts building and renovate it to house up 7 to 8 courtrooms all in that one building, right? That was the original intent. It could be done if you can relocate all the folks out of the office building. What would that allow us to do? You build the new office addition, move all court staff, support staff into the office addition. You would renovate the criminal court building, if we could back up one, renovate the criminal court building, that would allow all court in Alamance County to happen in that one building, with the exception of an occasional use of the historic courthouse. The courts that happen in civil would be able to move into J.B. Allen, so you would have eight courtrooms in the J.B. Allen courthouse with the creation of the office addition. All the courts would happen there. We've had these discussions with the clerk's office, with the sheriff's office. There is efficiencies to be gained if all court, all trials, all cases are being held in the same building as opposed to three different locations. So we could see that there would be some good use there. We also, what that would also allow us to do is to renovate civil court right next to this building, and it become part of county office building. So you wouldn't be building a new facility for county government. There's no new construction for county offices. The new construction would be the office addition, renovating J.B. Allen for courts, renovating the civil building, which would be empty of all court staff and all court rooms. That would become a place for county departments, some other county departments to move in, consolidate county government into the county office building. So,
Ricky, you got enough parking there?
Well, that's the second piece on the that's the second piece on the facility. So the first and main and critical piece is the office addition. That, if you do that, it frees up space in J.B. Allen and starts allowing these things to happen.
Now, what's where that office addition is right now? Is that not where the DA's office is, or is it?
That's where the CSI building is now. Right. It used to be the Board of Elections. That building would need to be demolished, which it is in pretty poor shape. It currently needs an entire roof replacement, and we'll be working with the sheriff about the possibility of relocating those folks out of there because the building itself is just not that great of a building. So that would be a building that would have to come down. The second major piece that would should be considered if we're going to move in this direction is the parking deck, east parking deck. So yes, once you start bringing all these folks into an all court and all clerks and staff and DAs and everybody parking, we would be looking at a parking deck along Maple Street, multi-level, accessible from, can you back out just one click, I'm sorry, accessible from both Elm and from Pine Street. If you'll notice, that also requires the removal of the Board of Elections. The Board of Elections really would benefit from having a place where they could have their staff and all their machinery in the same place. Their machinery right now, all their equipment's over in the old Ralph Scott building off Turntine Street. We have got to find another location for that. That is causing us issues with Ralph Scott. They have been very gracious to allow us to keep the equipment there, but we're starting to have issues with them from a HIPAA perspective because they have patients and folks in there. We're in a section of their building with hundreds of voting machines.
So there's a future jail expansion where the Board of Elections is located now?
Yes, the parking deck and the future jail piece would be on the site of the Board of Elections. So that would be a group that we would be working to maybe relocate into the civil piece. You know, they may be able to come into there once the office addition was created. So. The next piece that would be built, so you got your parking deck. The next along the line is a courtroom expansion. Our discussions with the district attorney and the judges and the clerks have led us to understand that there would be some value in eventually having a very large courtroom at the J.B. Allen facility. Right now, when they do events like traffic court, they don't have a room near large enough to put all the people in. They'll have hundreds of people come to traffic court. A lot of folks are standing out in the halls, they're standing outside, they're doing the telephone deal where they holler down the line to tell you your name's been called. There would also be some value in this space. This is a further down the road, right? This is a longer term development where if you picked up another district court judge for Alamance County and you had to start adding courtrooms, this would be the place where that could be done. It would also be in J.B. Allen, with the addition of the office building, you may only pick up 7 instead of 8 courtrooms because we still have to have a jury room. Eventually, when we would build this courtroom expansion, the jury room would move out here too. So you could have large facility for traffic court, a jury room, ability to expand if the judges or any of those support staff started expanding. This would be the place for that to happen. And then that's moving out into parking. Where folks that work at the courts as well as attend court park. So another further down the road possibility would be the west parking deck. This would be a larger deck that could go. All this will fit on this property. And let me reiterate, one of the main reasons for doing this was to try to figure out what the capacity of this site is so we don't go over there and just randomly build a building and then mess up our whole potential for the future, right?
So Greensboro, I'm sorry, let me interrupt you. I apologize. Built a $90 million jail. No parking.
Yes.
And that's a true story. Yeah. Am I right, Bruce?
Gotta have.
It beats all our songs.
Yes. And this is, again, a lot of caveats here. It's not to spec. It's not to scale. We feel like it's fairly close to scale. But the idea is, if we have this in our hands when we're talking about our needs, it's something that we can better plan. So parking deck would be a need, frankly, if you were going to take away a lot of this parking for court expansion. So it's certainly worth considering. The next item that would be in our wheelhouse, in our possible new building inventory, is a future jail. We all know that eventually we've had original jail. We built the other jail. When was the last one built, Sheriff? I can't remember the year. Was it 9? I can't remember when we built the new jail, off the top of my head.
Hadn't been long.
2007. Yes.
That was the ribbon cutting.
Yes.
Yeah. Hadn't been long.
So, you know, as Alamance County continues to grow, it's quite likely that we'll continue to need space for incarcerations. It's right now we're making use of the jail annex down kind of near the DOT facilities. What that means for the sheriff is he's having to transport food, he's having to transport laundry. I mean, having a separate annex is good in one way. It has provided space, but there is some, that's probably not the best thing to do in the future if we're going to construct. There is capacity on the lot across the street to build multi-story jail. It would require the removal of the Board of Education. Removal of the Board of Ed. Right.
Kind
of
convenient.
Yeah, right.
He said
nothing. Yeah, Board of Election building would have to be removed to put the future jail in. But there would be efficiencies, again, from sharing things like cafeteria service and laundry service. And not to mention the fact that if all court is happening on that same lot, and all inmates are on that same lot, from the sheriff's perspective, it makes it easier for him and his staff to be able to transport inmates back and forth to courtrooms if it's all happening in the same place. You know, I have to put them in cars, take them to three or four different locations.
Yeah, are you looking at a provision to get them from the jail to the court building without having to take them outside of the facility?
I am sure that we would. I know that there is some capacity for that now, but I think as we really start to think about how this might look, that would be a design that would be incorporated into it.
Make a lot of sense.
In the existing court facility now, in our new jail, we have a tunnel that goes over.
Okay.
So if all the buildings are connected, all the jail facilities are connected, then it's just much simpler to move inmates, because I would imagine if all of civil and all of criminal court was happening in J.D. Allen, it's not terribly often the sheriff's department's having to take people to historic. Not like you would be bringing folks to family court or domestic violence court or any child support court.
I think we could cut some staffing.
Uh-huh. So I think this is, we have one more piece that we have that would leave a capacity for a future building on the lot. That we really haven't determined what the use would be, but the capacity is there. That could be, again, it could be probation, parole. We currently have them down at the DOT lot now. The building's 7 or 8 years old, so it's not like there's a big rush to get folks out. But ideally, all that kind of juvenile justice, criminal court, criminal justice system proceedings are all happening on the same lot. So it also could be a good place for the Board of Elections. That lot slopes. One thing the Board of Elections has benefited from at Ralph Scott is it has a loading dock that has been very helpful when it comes to moving the machinery in and out. So with the slope of this lot, that could happen there too. But it's a future building. It is the furthest out, the furthest possible development. So let's talk, I know it's fast. Oh yeah, we do have some street level pictures. So this is conceptual idea of what the jail could look like. There's the parking deck. There's you're looking at Pine Street and South Maple. That little, the other little orange building is the new Sallyport that would have to be constructed. And this would be the new front of the J.B. Allen Courthouse with the, you can see the top of the jail construction over in the upper left. That building right in the front foreground is the office addition, what it might look like. You see the war memorial there, the little orange war memorial, and then the new court office expansion and a courtroom expansion is there in the upper right.
I just have to ask you, this was done by county staff.
No. No, this was done by outside folks. These pieces were...
Okay.
The conceptual part was somebody else.
Yes. Although, I don't know, we may have,
You could do that, couldn't you?
Couple days of training, he could.
Okay, so I'm going to talk, I think that's the end of our information about the Graham campus. I know that's very fast, but I wanted you to know that I think this facility planning process has brought to light possibilities across the street for the future for county government, for the courts. It's good news.
I'm glad you're planning for all that.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good way to do it.
Well, it's been, like I say, it's been a lot of different folks involved, and I have to give kudos to the court staff, district attorney, clerk, judges. They've all been very open and willing to meet with us, do space needs assessment, give us all kinds of information from their folks.
Let me ask you a real hypothetical. Have you linked any of this with what the population would have to be to support it with taxes, fees, and income?
So, in the capital plan, we're looking at next fiscal year, in our own capacity, our own debt capacity, without a tax increase, borrowing $5 million to do repairs.
Well, forgive me, I'm not trying to interrupt you, but to do this, total.
So I think the very first piece that could really actually happen without any tax increase at the current levels and is needed right now, because as you'll hear, I'm about to ask you to approve a lease so I can move juvenile justice out because they have no space. The one piece that I believe that could happen within the next about 24-25 fiscal year is the office addition that you see here, renovating J.D. Allen for all the courtrooms to happen there, and renovating the civil court building to make it county office building. What reason I say is because the way we have done our capital now, the way we've separated it out from operations, and we're retaining our debt capacity, we'll have the capacity to borrow an additional $15 million without any tax increases, without doing anything else, just because of how we're going to do our capital. So we have the ability in our own capital plan to finance $20 million with no impact to taxes. We're planning for $5 million next year to make fixes all over county government. The other $15 million, I believe, would fund that office addition and the renovations. And we could actually have all court in one building, this entire building, county office building and civil, beat county, and all the clerks, staff, DA, judges, and everybody in that building. The timetable would be in the next, we'd be able to borrow all that money by fiscal year 24. So I believe it can be done. Now, the parts about building the new jail.
That's what I'm talking about. Top end. Mm. Yeah.
That's further out. That's further out.
So. But with our projected growth going to 204,000 by 2035, these are things we have to be taking account of, or otherwise we're going to be playing catch-up ball like we have in the past.
And I think if we've entered this new model of trying to leverage debt we're paying down, take advantage of it, not raise taxes, yeah, that's new to us, but I think if we maintain that model, we may be able to do some additional work besides what I'm seeing in my mind quicker. But I think the key piece is having a plan that keeps us from messing up that property, going over there and dropping a building with no thought, just because we have the land and you haven't looked at the whole canvas, right?
I think it's really awesome to think prospectively and not react like Commissioner Carter said. I also think that a huge supporter of this plan should be the city of Graham, because we could do what other counties have done and just buy a piece of undeveloped land out remotely. Wentworth and Rockingham County comes to mind. They built a new judicial center out in a field, more or less.
Away from the
city. So everybody who needs to use it has to drive there, which increases congestion around the county. And I think that continuing to have county government centered in Graham supports the tax base here, and people are going to lunch, people are using other services here, coordinating trips and so forth. And I think it's very good to use density and in planning.
It brings people to downtown Graham too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. I think
has ABSS taken a look at the 204,000 people and what percentage of those would be students, and factored that into what our needs are going to be out there for 15 years, 16 years, as far as new capacity is concerned? Is it what we're doing right now in the bond going to cover all of that, or are we going to be needing to look at some more?
It's really hard to project
growth that far out. So we've got some ideas of the direction that we're headed, but you're talking, you know, 15 years out, it's really difficult to project what that growth is going to look like.
I'm just thinking of taking it as a percentage of the existing population, of the new population, as a student population, and just a hypothetical, where would we be? Just a thought.
Well, yeah, it's left a lot, but yeah.
I think you may remember from your work on the committee for the aging.
Right.
That a big, larger percentage of the people expected to be here are going to be older people, maybe less using of the school system and more needing elderly services such as EMS and the Meals on Wheels and the Alamance Elder Care and things like that.
And we are looking at becoming more of a senior citizen community in Alamance County.
Well, let's go ahead and move on to the Martin Street campus, because I want to touch on all three of these campuses, and I am respectful of time. And I had to really think about presenting this information today with the budget, because I know it takes a long time, but they are connected, right? The recommended budget is connected to this facility plan. So for Martin Street, just to orient you, this is Graham Hopedale Road and Martin Street. The environmental health and ag are on the corner there. So. The environmental health, ag building, family justice center, elderly services are currently on this property. So as you look at this site, this is a conceptual idea of what the property could look like. You'll notice one thing, our environmental health is no longer there. Environmental health is actually one of our worst buildings that we have. It is one that we should consider demolishing and relocating those employees. And we think we may be able to relocate them in time over toward the HSC campus, but we'll talk about that in a moment. And you'll also, the biggest piece that sticks out here that really is the anchor point is the Emergency Services Center right at the corner of Graham Hopedale Road and Park Street. This is where the Ag Building currently sits now. So I've had some discussions with Mark Danieli and Brad Moore about if we were really going to do this, would they be interested in maybe forming a committee to talk about where is the future of the ag services for Alamance County? Where should that be? You know, they're limited right now with their garden space. This lot is turning into very much a human service provision area between the Divergent Center for mental health patients, as well as Family Justice serving many of the domestic violence victims. So it's worthwhile for them to think about this. But both of those buildings, environmental health is not good at all. Ag is a better building, but not great.
Well, the environmental health dates back to the tuberculosis.
That's yes. Right. Yeah. That's exactly right.
It's old.
I always understood it had the big porch for that purpose. You could wheel people out, and they take fresh air back in long ago. So this emergency service center located, that would be a proposed new building located there on the corner. It would house Alamance County CCOM, Alamance County Emergency Management, Fire Marshal's Office, the Emergency Operations Center, the EOC, as well as all the emergency management equipment we currently store in Birds, the old Birds tractor. We have got to find a new place for that. We're being told we have about another year on that lease. So this facility, ideally all of this emergency service departments would be housed in a new constructed building on the corner. We believe that we would be able to get maybe even EMS, an EMS mechanic location in this building too. One thing that I would certainly recommend, and I've had this discussion with the City of Burlington, and they are interested in this too, is it would be very valuable. It would be invaluable for Alamance County CCOM 911 Center and the Burlington 911 Center to at the least be co-located, to be in the same room together, no longer Alamance County having to transfer calls to the City of Burlington if it's determined that the City of Burlington needs to process the call. Anytime you're transferring, anytime you have two call centers, it's time and it's chance of error. And I firmly believe that I'm not even talking about putting them under one roof as far as a department. I'm talking about just having them sit together, Burlington and the county. Would make a huge difference when people call 911 in the City of Burlington and they need some service. Both of these groups would be in this new Emergency Services Center, and I think if that could be accomplished, it would put us in a position to get state assistance to build this building, because the state 911 folks look very fondly on consolidating 911 centers.
Right.
I think Rockingham County, some of our staff traveled up to Rockingham. Bruce, I don't remember how much they got from the state. A $9 million grant from the state to build a new consolidated 911 center in Rockingham County. we would try to do the same thing. Apply for funds, point to the fact that we're going to co-locate these two 911 centers together and put fire marshal and emergency management all in one building with their equipment would be ideal. So
can they not join together physically as well as being co-located?
That is a possibility. I think
it's kind of like a redundancy of services to me.
Yes. I'm at the point where I think having them sit together is so valuable. Having them consolidated in some way would be valuable too. Absolutely. It just I think having them physically located is probably a little less to work through. But in the long run, yes, absolutely.
I mean, animal shelter, we have to do it with the city and
yes,
everybody else. And sometimes those things save money in the long run.
That's true. That is correct. I think this is another building that could happen sooner than we think if we're able to work out the co-location deal at least and apply for grant funding from the state.
So Randolph County may have done the same thing because I know they've got a new center beside their sheriff's department. Their sheriff's department's in with their main building.
Mm-hmm.
And then over to the left, then the jail's on back in the back. And in the middle, they've got a new 911 center as well.
This move would also free up a room in county office building down in the basement, free up space. So I'm gonna go through this really quickly because I won't take up too much time. But we also have the diversion center on this property. We have funds in hand for this project from Cardinal, as well as some commitment of funding from Mr. Petrie, if all goes well and hit on the building he's constructing over behind HSC. So this is for our mental health diversion center to keep mental health patients out of jail and out of the emergency room. That building is still there in the future. And of course, Family Justice Center, domestic violence headquarters for Alamance County. It would stay. The good thing in this scenario is the fire marshal, emergency management, and the EOC would all move out of this building over to the new constructed emergency management building, freeing up space for DSS, put some additional divisions in here that they had talked about would benefit from being near domestic violence folks. And the last piece on this property that we've identified is the capacity for a 20 to 40,000 square foot building, new construction built. If you're familiar with this lot, when you look at the Family Justice Center, like a pine woods there on the right, there is capacity in that lot. The county owns that lot to construct another building. I don't have a projected use. It was just helpful to identify it as another site that could be built out. And the last campus I'm going to talk about is the HSC campus. This, of course, is the Old County Hospital property. One thing I will say, and this is a part that there is so much interest in the provision of human services in East Burlington in the Graham Hopedale Road corridor. One of the first things we did was attend a meeting over at ARMC where nonprofits from all over the county, the hospital, were invited to be a part of a discussion about human service provision on the Graham Hopedale Road corridor. And I was amazed at the number of folks that showed up. So just to boil this down, what we have found is, I believe that HSC campus, this includes the Cronodal lot, which if you can hit one more time, I'll show you the Cronodal lot in relation. You know, we demolished the Cronodal Clinic building. We've retained the property. There you go. So there's a picture of the county hospital on the right of Graham Hopedale Road, the Cronodal property on the left. I really believe what we need to do is and I've talked with Impact Alamance about this. I believe Impact Alamance will help us fund a plan process specifically for this property. There are so many different groups that are interested in, these are large groups, Cone and some other larger scale groups. We just were not able to really focus on all the potential that could be done at the HSC lot. What we have determined is the county office building, we've got 300 to 400 people that work in that building, and it needs some significant work. So of our $5 million worth of installment loan debt that we're planning to take on in 1920, we're planning on doing some significant HVAC work there. But all that to say, there's capacity for anywhere from 20 to 40,000 square feet of new construction on the Cronodal side. There's another 16,000 square foot capacity on the Old County Hospital side that could be constructed. We do know that the Mr. Petrie building is going to be built in the back piece of the Human Service Center lot. So while I don't have a actual full-blown what are we going to do with HSC, what I do know is Health and DSS are going to remain there for a little while longer. We're going to make some repairs to that building. I believe we can commission a group to do a planning project for this property. Not with our funding. I believe we can find outside funding to help do that, but it merits that. There's just so much interest in it that I felt like I would be doing a disservice if I tried to come in here with a solution that we had come up with all on our own without
any. When social services and the health department moved in that building, didn't we spend $5 million refurbishing it?
We spent a significant amount of money. I think that was mid-90s, 96, 7, I believe.
That's my memory, yeah.
So, yes, the county did invest in that facility pretty heavily to get health and DSS in there. And I will say, talking with other counties around the state, it is one factor that works very well in our citizens' favor is that they are co-located, that health and DSS are both together in the same building. They provide a lot of services to the same clientele, and it's good, it's convenient for them to be able to come in and get all that in the same place. So I don't want to shortchange the HSC campus, but I think the takeaway is there's a tremendous amount of capacity to do construction on that may or may not be county. It might be some private construction interested in this, but we need to spend a little bit more time on figuring that out. In the meantime, we're going to plan to make repairs to the buildings. Just in summary from the facility plan process, I think we've made some great decisions about demoing buildings that needed to be gone. 70,000 square feet of building space that was just terrible is gone. We have good assessments of county and court buildings now, and we know the space needs of all those tenants. I think we have a good, solid 7-year plan for how to make repairs to county buildings. And I think we've done a good job projecting out the future of how county properties can develop. More work to do at HSC, but we will certainly do that. And I think the one thing I hope that the board will take away is we've come up with a good way to communicate project process, particularly for the bonds, because we know there's going to be a lot of interest in that. So we're committed to managing our capital well and to communicating it to you and to our citizens well too. So if you have any questions about the facility plan process, I'll certainly try to answer them, but this represents the direction that we are going to move, and we will be bringing projects to you for your approval as we do. So we'll move at your pace, at the board's pace.
Where are you going to store this report? I mean it seriously, because 5 years, 10 years down the road, you know, we people have gone back in the past. That, well, let me see the 2020 report, mm-hmm. the whatever report. Nobody can find it.
This will be on our county website. It will be posted on the county's website. So as school system, ACC, and the county work together on projects, and we'll be updating it online. So
just don't lose it, for God's sake.
No.
A lot of work went into that. It really is amazing.
We'll all be gone by.
They're going to bury us over there.
Maraski will still be here. But let me ask a question about, and maybe I should have asked it in the past presentation, but what are the feelings about the state school bond referendum as far as timing? Is it going to go on the ballot? Does anybody know?
The last word I saw from the Association of County Commissioners, there were still two models being discussed. It was a House model and a Senate model. One was kind of a pay-go. Another one was a bond-type selling bond project. I have not heard lately which one has really gained any traction. I know the Association had been real good about sending out updates, so I haven't seen anything lately, so I assume that means it's still being, both are still being debated. But I do know that both the House and the Senate, we're aware that it's been some time since the state has done a construction bond, and lots of communities are in the same boat we are. Tremendous growth, so many people moving to North Carolina, and counties need the state's assistance to keep up with it. So
there's a lot of counties in the opposite situation from ours, with depleting populations, mm-hmm. But they still have children that need to be educated, and the PAC space can't support new construction, and so it's really tough on them. But that reminds me that Mr. Haygood and I think Commissioner Carter and I are going day after tomorrow for City County, right, or for County Assembly Day at the General Assembly, and I expect we'll have opportunity to see Senator Gunn or Mr. Riddell or Mr. Ross, and we'll ask them if they have any.
I don't think there's any question. It goes on the ballot. It'll pass statewide.
Yes.
And that's and I'd be willing to gamble a little bit with some of my planning that would take place if we just knew the timing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, Commissioner Gailey was so kind to point out that I serve on the Committee on Aging, and one of the pieces of information one of the pieces of information we've gleaned in that was that if you're between 50 and 85, and I look around the room, and a lot of us qualify for that, the probability now is that you will live
to be somewhere between 110 and 115 years old.
I hope so.
Whoa.
I hope so.
Just think about that. Now, that's here in Alamance County. Think about that, too, how much need there will be for senior citizens.
I'm going to
get rid of
some of my bad habits.
Come on, enjoy it.
Who did that study, Steve?
Right.
Who did that study?
That's right.
Wow.
The maker of Geritol.
Thank you for that, that facility plan. That's just amazing.
That is.
I'm blown away by, I know that you've been working on that for a very long time and had a lot of assistance from your staff and other people. Somebody around here has done a really good job.
A lot of work behind the scenes by folks. Certainly
appreciate it. I think I'll give credit to the county manager for looking ahead.
Amen. Well, the county team, I mean,
that's right, absolutely.
This is what we need to really be running the county like a business.
Yeah.
Taking a forward look at where we need to be, anticipating those needs, and anticipating how we're going to finance them before we get there and trying to struggle on raising taxes.
Absolutely.
Well said. That's right. Preach. Okay, so lease of office space for juvenile justice.
So I'm requesting that the board approve leasing space for the juvenile justice group. This group is growing due to the state's recent changes to legislation that raised the age of juvenile offenders. So the state is going to be sending an additional 4 juvenile justice employees to Alamance County to become part of the team that works here. They are out of office space. They're currently housed in the basement of the civil court. They're out of space. I'm proposing to lease space for this group at 114 South Maple Street, which is in the buildings right next door to county office building and civil court. A number of attorney offices. There are 2 one-story buildings there. So the reason why we're asking for this is that unit is growing and we have no place else to put them. This all ties into our facility plan that we just talked about. Eventually, I would foresee these folks being located in that office addition to the courthouse. The lease that you have before you is for 1 year with options to extend it. The cost is $36,000 per year. We have included that dollar amount in the manager's recommended budget for 1920 that you have received. And again, I think this is a temporary solution for juvenile justice, but we're going to be, I think this month we received 1 of the new employees. Is that right, Sherry?
Yes.
And then the rest will be coming in. So they're already starting to come. And this is just one of those things where the state says, we're making changes, we're hiring new people, county, show us where we're going to put them. So I feel like this lease is appropriate to do in a limited term until we can move on some of our longer term scenarios. So if you have any questions.
That's for 1 year.
It is for 1 year. We have the option to renew it for 2 more if we choose to do that.
At the same price.
There is an increase, I believe, built into it or as being discussed. So
it's negotiable at the end of each term.
After each term.
Yeah.
Okay, so we need a motion to
so
approve
move.
The lease.
Second.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the lease of office space for juvenile justice. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, you have a health insurance update for us.
Yes, commissioners, I'm going to just give you information about what I'm planning, some actions that I'm planning on taking. This does not require a vote, but I want to give you an update about our employee health insurance plan, and it is in particularly concerning the option of our insurance plan that deals with a high deductible and the health savings account. So in March of this year, we learned from our former broker that the high deductible plan that approximately 337 of our employees have chosen as their health insurance, that these employees could not use the employee clinic for any reason other than preventative. This was not communicated to county staff or to the employees, and we didn't have any idea that this was a problem until this March. We learned it from our broker. So during open enrollment, last year, the employees did not receive this information. So we feel like, and we know, that a lot of these employees made a decision to go with this high deductible plan because they believed they could use the clinic for any purposes that they wanted to, but they cannot. So we have ended our agreement with the brokers. They are no longer our brokers. In fact, we have put out a proposal for new brokers and have received in a number and are evaluating those now. County Manager's Office, the Human Resources Office, and the Legal Department have worked together to find a solution for this problem. Because basically what you have is well over a third of our employees have made a selection for an option of a plan that they are really not able to take the full advantage of that they thought. That they thought they would get free clinic visits, and they cannot. So what I am recommending that we do is we put, we've determined that a fair market value for a clinic visit to the employee clinic is $40. I'm recommending, or I'm planning to, again, this doesn't take a vote from you, but I'm planning to give each employee that has signed up for the high deductible plan an additional allocation of $320 into their health savings account. They started the year off with $600. I'm going to put an additional $320 into each plan. Employees can use these for whatever bills they want to, but they will have to pay for the clinic from now on. If they go to the clinic, they have to stay on this high deductible plan until the end of the calendar year. If they use the clinic for anything other than preventive, they're going to have to pay. So I feel like putting this funding, this additional money in their health savings account will pay for visits that they have made between January 1 and today, as well as ones that they may want to go in the future. This was hard news for us. It certainly was tough to take 3 months into the calendar year, and I will tell you that is why we are looking for a new broker. But the total cost is $112,000 to make this additional contribution to these 300-plus employees HSA fund. What I will do, our current fund projection, as you know, we've been struggling in our health insurance fund. Currently, we are projecting that we will bring in almost $1 million in revenue over expenditures this year. That is good news. If that stays the current trend, we'll cut our deficit in half. But I'm going to plan to take this $112,000 from that additional revenue. So this is not taking it out of tax dollars or out of general fund or anything like that. It's all happening within the health insurance fund. But I have talked to the county legal department about pursuing legal action against our broker, Pierce. And our hopes would be that we regain some, if not all, of that $112,000. That would be our goal. But in the meantime, I feel like the right thing to do is to put this funding into these employees' health savings account. And hopefully that will help them offset costs that they did not expect to have for the rest of this calendar year. Again, there's no action needed by the board. This is an update, and we will be communicating this plan to the employees today. So, but I wanted to be sure the board knew about it. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer.
How many additional visits would that allow them? Would that provide financing for them to use?
So we,
with the clinic,
we've fair market value of a clinic visit to our clinic's $40. So we've had some that have gone to the clinic before they knew that this was the case, before we knew this was the case. They're going to have to pay for those visits that they've already made. So they'll be charged $40 per visit by the county. Then what we hope is there will be some money left, hopefully a significant amount of money left, that if they can use it, if they choose to. Now, it's important for me to note that the HSA money does not have to be used to pay for clinics, right? But if they chose to, they could do it. So if we put another $320 in there, my hope is that'll pay for some of the ones that they've already been to and give them some funding to pay for some additional clinic visits throughout the rest of the county.
How can they do that? Change that in the middle?
Well, the restriction existed before, but they didn't tell us as county staff that that was an issue. I mean, they knew, our brokers knew that our clinic is one of our biggest benefits for
right.
our employees.
Right.
So when we met with them to talk about how to structure county employee health insurance different this year because we have such a big deficit, and to offer some different choices, it was never told to county staff or to the employees, if you choose this high deductible model, you can't use the clinic the way that you thought
right.
until March. And at that point, we've already had folks go to the clinic, and people have made their decision and are locked into this plan for the next, till end of December.
Right.
So I feel like this is the right thing to do for these employees. I think it's regrettable that we weren't informed. My hope is that Mr. Albright and his team can help us get some of this money back, and I'm also excited that we're going to have a new broker here very soon.
And have we got a line on the broker that we will approach?
I think we've had 7 different proposals sent back to us, so we'll be evaluating those proposals and plan to meet with them and go through the interview process. But this was very disappointing. I've met with staff from our broker, and they were very apologetic, but you know, there's just that's not really any help at this point.
So they're not offered, excuse me, they've not offered any compensation to the county at all?
I don't think they're going to, unless they're persuaded.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll try to persuade them.
Well,
That sounds like a really good plan. Appreciate it.
So again, no action needed, but I do feel like it's
I think it's a good idea. We need to take care of our employees, definitely.
Yep. Do we have a prerequisite that these people have dealt in the past with government or government employees?
Yes. I think the group that we had, it deals with multiple governments. They're from here in North Carolina. It was, I can tell you, it was quite a shock to
hear.
They
still did what they did.
Yes.
What's their name?
Pierce. So, I mean, unless there's any other questions, that's the extent of my information. So.
Thank you. Okay, the next item on our agenda is to discuss a moratorium on the heavy industrial development ordinance. To discuss extending that, Mr. Albright?
You want to set the public hearing for the high impact land use development ordinance changes for June 3rd. And that's what's before you today. And that notice will extend, will consider extending the moratorium.
So
we need to set a public hearing for our June 3rd meeting and run our advertisements May 20th and May 27th.
So are we deciding today the length of that in voting to set the public hearing?
No,
are we saying this is for a 59-day extension?
No, you're just setting a public hearing to discuss the extension of the moratorium.
Okay, so will we still have the flexibility to do a moratorium for longer than 59 days?
Whatever the board decides after the hearing, yes.
Okay, we've got to have a public hearing.
Yes, okay. That's all you're doing today is setting
a public hearing. I make a motion that we have a public hearing on that on June 3rd.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to set a public hearing on extending the heavy industrial development ordinance moratorium, having that public hearing on June 3rd. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
When's the budget?
June 18th.
June 18th. That's night meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Okay, Ms. Evans, do you have something for us about an audit services contract?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, Commissioners. The Finance Department put out an RFP for our audit services. We're on a three-year cycle. We were at the end of the third year on fiscal year 18. We put that out for audit services to be performed for fiscal year 19, 20, and 21. We had five companies that responded to our RFP, and upon evaluating those, staff's recommendation is to award the bid to Martin Starnes and Associates for $90,000, and that would cover fiscal year 19, and then fiscal year 20 and 21 would be evaluated at that point in time.
Okay, so we need to have a vote.
Are they the same company that we're using now?
They are the same company that we have been using in the past. They are very experienced in dealing with governmental agencies and dealing with our county. They understand how our county works. We are very pleased with the relationship.
Based out of Georgia?
They're actually based out of Hickory.
Hickory, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Georgia.
And how much is that increase over what we paid this year?
It's actually an $8,000 decrease in the audit that we had performed this year.
It's getting better then.
I'll move that we do that.
For the change in
that. Okay, we have a motion and a second to, I guess, accept the staff's recommendation on awarding the audit services contract. And so is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you.
And then the next item that I have in there within that request is also to go ahead and approve the contract for fiscal year 19. And that will be there for your signature, Ms. Gailey.
Okay.
Do you need a motion
on
that?
It takes a vote on that as well.
I'll move that we approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the contract with the auditor for fiscal year 19. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Albright, the noise ordinance revision.
Yes, you have before you the final version as approved by the board at our April 16th meeting.
Pointed out that we don't have a provision are we have a provision for one area of industry, construction, and doing construction on residential properties, but we don't, and on commercial properties, a time limit on it. But we don't have, we're not willing to put one in there, or we can't put one in there apparently for something such as the mining operation.
Could we break out the class four uses under the heavy industrial development ordinance and subject those to a time limit under the noise ordinance? When we talked about this at the last meeting, we spent some time discussing that number four, the exemption under section 7, exemption number 14 is normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial or manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, provided that said businesses are operating in a lawful manner. And we spent some time talking about that. Could we pull out those businesses that are permitted under the class four uses of the heavy industrial development ordinance and put the same kind of time restrictions or the time restrictions that we had discussed before?
I would not recommend it because this ordinance is supposed to deal with unreasonable and disturbing and unnecessary noises. And as we discussed at our last meeting, there are normal sounds associated with industry and farming that there's no way to eliminate them. As we had a farmer here talk about the sounds of the country. I think he's here today. But those type of things are better dealt in a heavy industry ordinance and in zoning.
Well,
I think that's where we're headed.
If we talk about class four uses under the heavy industrial ordinance, that's not farming. Those are very specific. I mean, I'll have the thing in front of me right now, but if I recall, then it's the asphalt plant and the mining.
Under the
heavy industrial ordinance.
Well, the mining, I remember one of our speakers this morning, public speaker said she was 1,000 feet from the mine. And the mine under the permit, as I understand it, is purchased 2,500 feet. They have that much distance between them and the nearest house, 2,500. And the ordinance only requires 2,000. So they have exceeded that by 500 feet. And they're going to have buffers and berms and all these things that our heavy industry development ordinance took into consideration and requires. I think if you try to get at it from a noise ordinance, prohibiting existing businesses from making noise, I don't think it would be enforceable. We'll be tested on it, I feel sure. I just don't think you're going to find it enforceable. The way to deal with that is through the heavy industry ordinance and through zoning. One of our speakers again this morning, the gentleman from Snow Camp, indicated that five surrounding counties don't have these problems. Well, they have zoning. Guilford, Orange, Randolph, and that's how they deal with this. The way that we deal with it in this county is to spread the joy throughout the county with our high-impact land use ordinance, which is replaced with a heavy industry development ordinance, and that's all based on spacing requirements, which is not a good way to deal with it, in my opinion. And I think that's being addressed with the amendments to the heavy industry development ordinance. That's where it ought to be.
Have we got anything back from the state where they are on approving that process?
I haven't heard anything from them. Not a word since their last, I think it was in January or February, we heard from them last.
Isn't there a time limit for them also?
I don't know what the schedule is for the Mining Commission.
I mean,
or what depth they're going into.
I know if I lived in that part of the county and wanted to sell a piece of property and they put me in a hostage situation, I would call it, I would be very concerned.
Well, I understand how these folks feel. No one wants a mine next to their farm.
Right.
But in a county with no zoning, and anything can happen when someone sells their farm.
Now, with Martin Marietta and the ones that are already doing the gravel industry, where are they coming up with that time limit that the gentleman talked about today?
I don't know. I guess it's a business decision made on made by each company. There are several mines in the area, in Guilford,
I'm familiar with two. I don't know if they run 24/7 or not. I can't imagine they would operate that kind of equipment.
I know Martin Marietta
in the dark.
When I lived out that way, they're open at 7 and close at 5 in the afternoon because I know the guys run.
I'm just not really understanding why it's unreasonable to expect a heavy industry use, even if you can buffer, even if we could have zoning, which we do not have zoning. Sometimes I feel like the absence of zoning is an excuse not to try to reach for other solutions to help address our citizens' problems. I'm failing to understand why it's not reasonable to say an asphalt plant or a rock quarry, a mine, anything that's permitted under Class 4 of our heavy industry, that they should expect to cease operations while people are trying to sleep in their neighborhood.
Well, as we heard from the racetrack man, it's a business decision that the business makes based on their relationship with their neighbors. He shuts his racetrack down at 5 during the weekdays. I don't know what this outfit's planning to do. But this ordinance, the very nature of the ordinance, is supposed to eliminate unreasonably loud noises. As our county transitions from farmland to urban, these are the kind of things you expect.
Of course, that racetrack was grandfathered.
Well, it's been there over 60 years because I used to go there when it was a dirt track.
And it's not a Class 4.
Yeah. Well, and it's been there for a long, long time. So if you change that, not only will it affect businesses like that, but other businesses as well that are out in the country.
Other businesses like what?
Like Buckner Steel or the body shops that are out there in the country.
Are those Class 4?
I don't know.
Things?
Not in this ordinance, but an unreasonably loud noise would be covered by this. If someone's running his air compressor at 2 in the morning on a Sunday morning. But again, it's based on the facts and the development of the surrounding properties. So if you sell your farm and you have a sawmill beside your farm or a chip mill and neighbors move in, they're going to hear and smell sawdust and chips. How are you going to shut that
chip
mill down?
However, they buy knowing that was there as opposed to this is a opposite.
Well, I'm not saying that it's not that there are not changes that are necessary to the heavy impact heavy industrial development ordinance. The high impact land use ordinance was a terrible ordinance. And as I said before, the reason you changed it is because Payne Oil had no place to go under that ordinance, and we have to have business and industry.
Well, I'm feeling a little like we're beating our head against the wall with talking about the noise ordinance, because we've been talking about this for quite a few meetings now, but that's what we're elected to do, is we're elected to beat our head against the wall when it comes to certain things, because it's important to the community, it's important to the people that we're privileged to serve. And I would make a motion that we table this until the next meeting to investigate or to take a look at a draft. I would ask that we, as part of my motion, we instruct our legal department to draft a new draft with time prohibitions for Class 4 industry that is permitted under the Class 4 of our heavy industrial development ordinance, that they have some kind of reasonable time restrictions where they have to they're not exempted from the rest of the noise ordinance. Well, that would be my motion.
Is your intent to...
I'll second that motion.
Do you intend to apply that retroactively to existing businesses in the county?
I would think that anything that's already received its operational permit would be grandfathered in. That would not be a change to existing things, but that when we have a new asphalt plant, when we have a new quarry, permit, that it would be subject to a noise ordinance of some kind of PM to AM limit. That would be sort of like what Marietta already does, something that seems compatible with the rest of the industry as it currently operates.
Right.
That they don't have an expectation that they can operate 24/7.
Absolutely true.
I like the idea about matching it up to what Martin Marietta is already doing. I'd like for us to also look at that provision 7. I mean, if an individual in building operations is doing his own, trying to do some work on his own home, and he's working daytime hours, and we're limiting him to just a couple of hours at night, he can do some personal work. I can't imagine what he would be doing that would be making that much noise. But I know it's possible. But you basically told a guy if he's going to work on his own house, or if you've got a contractor working on a house in a residential area, that he has to cut off work during the summer pretty much at about sundown.
8 o'clock.
Yeah. I think we ought to look at extending that at least to the commercial one at 11 o'clock, if not.
Okay. So, Mr. Carter, I would amend my motion to include that instruction as well.
I appreciate that.
And so, Mr. Lashley, did you second that?
Still make the second.
So we have a second, or a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you so much. Okay, on to the budget amendments. We have a budget amendment from the Health Department.
Good afternoon.
All right, so in front of you, you have a budget amendment in the amount of $44,943. The Health Department received an additional allocation through the Department of Health and Human Services Division of Public Health in Agreement Addenda 874, which is our food and lodging program. And we're receiving this money based on the 100% compliance that we've achieved to the food and lodging inspections. And so just to give you a little bit of background, we receive initial allocations through the Division of Public Health for our food and lodging. And then we receive an additional allocation if the county achieves 100% compliance, which we did. And so if a county is less than 100% compliant in their food and lodging inspections, their money is then distributed to counties that did achieve 100%. So kudos to our team at Environmental Health, Terry Craver and Betsy Meeks and all of their staff who really work hard and committed to integrity and accountability and quality for our food and lodging inspections. And so the money will be spent on two vehicles, the CDP license, which is the software that we use for food and lodging inspections, for some computer equipment, including some GIS, mobile, and point of inspection equipment that allows staff to do most of the paperwork or most of the documentation in the field, and then some food and lodging supplies like the thermometers, the lights that we need. And these are all state dollars and no local match.
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment. Does anybody have any questions or concerns? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
All right, from the landfill, Mr. Hill?
Okay. I'm going to do the next two, and we'll get out of here quicker. So for landfill, we are asking to transfer $80,000 from a contingency line item to various line items for their heavy equipment operations and repairs.
So moved. Motion.
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
And the next one, from the Alamance Community Foundation, we have received $1,500, which needs to be then moved over to the War Memorial Foundation. We are just kind of the pass-through custodian of those funds, and those $1,500 will be used for cleaning and maintenance of the War Memorial.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve receiving that donation. Is there any discussion other than to say thank you?
Thank you.
To the Alamance Community Foundation
really?
And the people who are donating that. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, next on our agenda would be public speakers on items not related to agenda items, but we don't have anybody for that, so move right along. County Manager, do you have anything else to report today?
I'd just like to announce that we've appointed Susanna Goldman as our new Library Director. We're very excited about it. Susanna's been interim for about 6 months and has done an outstanding job. She's been with the library system for over 5 years, is well respected by the staff there, has done a good job with the budget process. I'm very pleased and welcome and congratulate Susanna on her new appointment.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm glad we promoted from within. Very good.
That's all.
Okay, yeah.
Do we have any commissioner comments?
I have one of concerned about some items I've seen recently concerning the animal shelter and their relationship with law enforcement. And Burlington, if I understand what I've seen correctly, assigns the management of the animal shelter to the
Humane Society.
Yeah, Humane Society. And then they're managing it. Is that not right?
Yeah. No, they have their own.
You would think they were.
Beg pardon?
They have their own on-staff management.
It's Burlington
the city does.
Yeah, they hired that person.
But they hired people from the Humane Society.
It's Burlington,
right?
Animal, yeah. Services, right. Is the organization that runs the animal shelter.
Okay.
But it's a staff level department.
Well, just from what I've seen in recent articles, it concerns me that we're seeing feral cats return into neighborhoods, and some of the issues I've had conversations with the sheriff's department about the way they've handled vicious dogs that were being brought in, and the way they were criticizing our deputies in animal control for the way they were handling vicious dogs. That just it doesn't bode well if we're trying to take on the lion's share for the expense of managing the animal shelter, and then have management of the animal shelter not respecting the fact that the county's a part of this too.
Yeah, I have to agree with them.
Yes,
if they don't do something to change, I'm going to stop funding it, go to fund it.
I share your concerns, and Mr. Haygood and I are going to meet tomorrow with Harden Watkins, the Burlington City Manager. And I am personally invested in seeing that the different municipalities have a voice and a say in things that relate directly to policies within the municipalities. And we're going to talk to the city of Burlington and
good.
See what we can come to a mutual understanding about what's appropriate as far as how decisions are made, whether or not a certain animal policy is good policy or bad policy. In my personal opinion, should be up to the individual municipalities to decide.
Yes.
And I think that when we agreed to fund a joint venture, that doesn't mean we agreed to see our sovereignty
over
a policy item to another organization within the county. So
exactly.
That's my personal opinion. But so far, I'm happy to say that Harden Watkins has been listening and has been approachable, and I have every confidence and expectation that the whole issue is going to be resolved in an amicable and mutually agreed upon way.
Absolutely.
So, okay. Are there any other comments? Okay. If not, then we'll be adjourned. Thank you.
So.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.